and Amy Westling, the Interim Executive Director of the Association of Regional Center Agencies. And after the third panel, we will have public comment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and happy to be here and appreciate the opportunity to continue the discussion on this very important topic. And I have here with me as well Dr. Lovell, who is part of our team, and we'll have a moment later for her to present some information on the data as part of the newly formed research team that we have. I'd like to also just take a second to acknowledge the staff's work on the background. The work that was presented in the background paper is very helpful and gives a really broad overview of the issues that we're facing today. I'd also like to just take a second to thank the families that have traveled very far. We've had a number of families from Southern California that I understand were up at 3 o'clock this morning to get into their vehicles to join us today to share their thoughts and the importance and the challenges that they're facing. So I'd like to acknowledge not only the work and the efforts that they do to advocate for their loved ones, but being here today to share their stories. So in 1969, the Lanterman Act was signed into law to ensure that individuals with developmental disabilities would receive services and supports to enable them to live more independent lives. The department contracts with 21 regional centers to provide these services and supports to eligible individuals regardless of their age, race or ethnicity, spoken language, or economic status. Currently, regional centers serve and support approximately 305,000 individuals. Our consumer population is extremely diverse, representing at least 23 ethnicities and 45 spoken languages. Over the past 10 years, the regional center system is seeing changes in their population to include a significant shift in the primary ethnic groups served by regional centers. In 2006, whites were the largest ethnic group, representing 41% of the consumer population. In that year, the Hispanic population comprised 33% of all regional center consumers. Today, Latinos is the largest community in the regional center consumer population, representing 39% of all individuals served by regional centers. As the chair noted, in 2012, the Senate Select Committee on Autism and Related Disorders held an informational hearing which discussed the equal access to regional center services for consumers with autism spectrum disorders. At that time, and continuing today, we are seeing that the data indicates that disparities in service access and different ethnicities still exist. Since 2012, several pieces of legislation have been enacted to address disparities in services, to include AB 1472, requiring the department and regional centers to compile data related to purchase of service authorization, utilization, as well as expenditure with respect to consumers' age, race, or ethnicity, primary language, residence type, and disability. The statute further requires regional centers to post their data on their websites on an annual basis, as well as meeting with stakeholders to report what the department report to the department whether their data indicates the need to reduce disparity. Also, in 2013, statute was enacted requiring the expansion to the state's quality assessment instrument, the National Core Indicators for measuring outcomes and satisfaction, to also measure services that are provided in culturally competent manner. Additionally, in the fiscal year of 15-16, as a department, we required that the survey to families be printed in translation to all Medi-Cal threshold languages, allowing for every individual to be able to provide input in their language of preference. Additionally, during in-person interviews, if it's outside of the Medi-Cal threshold languages, the State Council is also able to provide verbal translation to any language spoken in the for any individual in our system. In 2013, there was also statute enacting and requiring the regional centers to communicate with consumers and their families in their native language in providing services. Also in 2013, there's a mandate to annually train the regional center board members, including training on cultural competency, and that the board annually reviews a regional center executive director's performance in providing the services that are culturally appropriate. Statute in 2015 was enacted requiring regional centers to offer, and upon request, a written copy of the consumer's IPP in a threshold language, and within 45 days being able to provide that. The Welfare and Institution Code requires annual monitoring of the regional center board composition by the department to ensure that regional centers are conforming to the statutory requirements, ensuring that regional centers' governing board reflects the geographic and ethnic characteristics of their community. The regional center annual performance contracts also provides an opportunity for a review of measurable objectives to assess regional centers' performance and policy measures. In 2015, statute was amended requiring the performance contracts measure progress in reducing disparities and improving equity in purchase of service expenditures. There's an opportunity for oversight through the dashboard that is on the department's website. This is through 2016 enacted trailer bill language requiring that quality access measures be posted on our website to allow for not only the department but for the community to be able to see and to provide oversight on the different measures and reporting requirements that the regional centers have. ABX21 was an opportunity in which during special session last year provided funding for regional centers to hire a cultural specialist, as well as the department has a cultural specialist position in which we're recruiting for. As of now, 16 of the 21 regional centers have their cultural specialist hired. ABX21 also appropriated $11 million to implement plans and activities to promote equity and reduce disparities in the purchase and provision of services. During this time, the department held four different stakeholder meetings throughout California to help inform us, to be able to assist us in identifying priorities for approval of the plans that this regional center submitted to the department. Before I introduce Dr. Lovell, I would like to briefly share with you some of the things that we've heard from the community during the times that we've met with our stakeholders. Families have shared with us that they're facing challenges in understanding their array of service options, specifically if it's not in the language in which there is their primary and chosen language. Ability to navigate through multiple agencies when accessing generic services. Language, cultural, and transportation barriers. Obtaining services in rural communities. Families lack a trust in government systems and in some cases to include the service coordinators. For families in poverty, the ability to secure basic necessities such as stable housing and medical care. Families and advocates have shared that some cost-saving measures such as social rec and the non-federally mandated services for children in Early Start between 2009 and 2012 has impacted the underserved communities more so than the other communities. Families have also shared the challenge of finding a provider that can communicate in the family's primary language and understand cultural differences and preferences. We are pleased to see in the proposals that were submitted to us for the $11 million that they were consistent with trying to address and begin to address some of the issues that have been shared by the stakeholders. I recognize this is not an exhaustive list of barriers, and we continue to have to listen and to understand where the core issues are, but I want to assure the legislature and the community that we will continue as a department and myself as the director to engage with the stakeholders and advocates, as well as to work with our new research unit to review and analyze disparity data to further understand what the barriers or root causes are that we face and preventing families in accessing services. And so with the chair's permission, I'd like to have Dr. Lovell provide just a brief overview of some of the data that we've been able to research.
Yeah, and I don't, I can ask some questions now. I can wait until both of you, whichever you prefer.
I'm comfortable with either way.
In terms of why the, when you look at the white versus Latino average consumer expenditure, the disparity appears to be almost identical today to what it was 5 years ago. Could you just address that? You would expect that, because I know there have been efforts, why that disparity hasn't gone down.
You know, I wish I had the answer to that, you know, because, you know, when you take a look at efforts that have been made over the years, you would want to see the needle move. And I think that's the benefit to having the new research team that we have at the department to help us drill into some of the detail. The other, if you take a look at, and again, it's not an excuse, and I certainly don't want to present it as an excuse, but if you take a look at much of the legislation that's occurred over the last few years, there's still efforts to operationalize a lot of those efforts, and so we're still having to continue to measure and make sure that we're measuring the progress of those efforts. So what I'm really wanting to make sure that we do is that everything that we have in legislation, the opportunities that we have with, say, the additional $11 million and the things that have been afforded to us, that we're able to operationalize them, that we are then able to also clearly identify a way that we can start measuring progress. That's an area that I really want to take a look at and working not only with Dr. Lovell, but bringing together a group of experts in the field to also give input into how do we measure some, because there's so much detail within the data, it gets extremely complex. Again, I'm not minimizing it, but I think we have some more work to do to understand what is in the data and then also to understand where some of the progress has been made or not made so we can adjust our strategies.
Sure. And I understand it takes time to implement legislation and there's more work to do. And I'm not suggesting that between 2012 and today you would have necessarily completely solved the problem. But one would expect that there would have been some progress, because even without legislation, even without the $11 million, you know, there was a very stark problem that was presented and Correct. Discussed intensely. I was in the legislature at the time. From what I understand, it was a very intense hearing in 2012, and you would think that over a five-year period, we could at least see some improvement. Again, not right. necessarily 100% solution, but some improvement. And so I think you'll, you know, understand why we're, it definitely causes me concern, and if my colleagues were here, I'm sure it would cause them concern, that the needle does not appear to have moved at all, at least based on those top-line numbers. I'm sure we'll hear more about other efforts, and I don't want to suggest that nothing's been done, that's being blown off. I'm sure. not suggesting that. But there's clearly something amiss that over a five-year period, those numbers haven't changed.
Yeah, and we share your concern. Some of the areas that I think will also be helpful for us to do is to identify what are some of the other measures that we can start taking a look at as well. I had mentioned the board comp as a requirement that the board needs to reflect their community. We have seen some progress in that area where the regional centers, there's more regional centers in compliance with the board comp. And while that may sound like an easy answer to go ahead and say, let's go ahead and make sure that the board is representative of the community and it's an easy fix to just go ahead and get board members on. The fact that there's terms related to the boards, so it may take several years for a regional center to implement kind of their plan to be able to add additional Latinos onto their board, or, you know, whatever the community mix is. So we have seen a significant increase in compliance in this area. We've also seen some of the regional centers that have made some progress as far as implementing strategies. You'll hear some more in a little bit about from Frank D. Lannerman's Pomodoro model. I believe Amy is going to be addressing this for you today. And so while it's not a statistically kind of formal process, some of the reports that I've seen as far as the efforts that the community has made there has shown some progress as far as some of the outreach and the navigation and making sure that families are accessing services. It's scratching the surface. We have more work to do. But I think that we need to continue to take a look at where are some of the areas that are working well. So in those instances, we can also start replicating some best practices. You know, the cultural specialists that each of the regional centers are getting and with the cultural specialists that we have at the department, we'll be able to start bringing people from a statewide perspective together to start doing some cross discussions. We have to continue the engagement with stakeholders, but we also need from a statewide perspective to bring together and say what is working, where are we seeing some of the progress and how can we replicate that throughout the state as well.
And are you, in terms of at the 21 regional centers, I assume there are some different things being tried at different centers. How is that information shared? Is DDS like a clearinghouse, or how does it work if something seems to maybe be working in one center or not working? Mm-hmm. If something's been a failure, how is that information shared?
So there's Through the regional centers, the Association of the Regional Centers, there's an equity committee, and so I'm not as familiar with that process as certainly Amy, as well as the director from East LA that will be speaking today. But there's definitely avenues for the sharing of the information. However, from a statewide perspective from the department, we've not had that opportunity. And then bringing together, as I was saying, this, the culture specialists that we're going to have monthly meetings and calls with all of the cultural specialists within the regional centers, pulling that information together so we can start addressing some of the best practices. There's some great things that are happening. There's also some things that are not probably working, and we need to share that information. We're going to be engaged in that process, and we're going to do so through the positions that have been allocated and supported in the last year's budget.
Great. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And so would it be okay to have Dr. Lovell provide some information for you today? Thank you.
Thank you, and good afternoon. I'll be very brief. Our administrative data tells us what services each consumer receives, and it tells us part of the story of why there are differences in that service receipt, but it doesn't tell us why some other differences occur. For example, focusing on differences between Latino and white consumers, our data shows that age plays a role in disparities. For one thing, expenditures across all ethnicities tend to be higher for consumers as they age, and there's a big difference between the average age of our Latino consumers compared to the white population. Nearly three-quarters of our Latino consumers are younger than age 22, whereas about half of white consumers are in that age group. So there are many more Latino consumers who are in the age group that might be receiving services through the school system. Where individuals live also has a large impact on the cost of their services. Of consumers age 22 and older, 7 of 10 Latinos live at home, compared to 4 of 10 whites. In addition, service expenditures vary quite a bit depending on what a consumer's disparities diagnoses are. So if we put those factors together and look at the ratio of average expenditures for Latino consumers to average expenditures for white consumers, we can get some insight into where disparities are rising. As the chair noted, if we look at that ratio, average expenditures for Latinos to average expenditures for whites, for all consumers, the ratio is about 45%. If we account for some of the age differences between those two populations and look only at adult consumers, that age ratio is 61%. If we also take into account where consumers are living and focus only on consumers who live at home, that ratio then becomes 79%. And if we focus in a little bit more, looking at the impact of diagnosis, look at the ratio for adult consumers who live at home and have autism, that expenditure ratio is 91%. So administrative data cannot explain why consumer groups differ in where they're living, whether they're living at home or in community facilities. And that's where, as the director was saying, we turn to input from regional centers and our communities themselves to understand where those differences arise. I also wanted to mention that the new research section at the department is currently assessing disparities data in accordance with AB 1606, and we are preparing the first of our annual reports that are required to the legislature, which we will submit on May 1st of this year. That report will look at compile state and regional center level data on disparities in service authorizations, expenditures, and utilization rates for fiscal years 2012-13. Through 2015-16. In that report, we'll be able to look at the interaction of some consumer characteristics in more detail, such as differences in service access for Latino consumers whose primary language is Spanish and Latino consumers whose primary language is English, and also the ethnic and age diversity of consumers who are diagnosed with autism. We will examine the characteristics of consumers who have no service authorizations or expenditures, so receiving service coordination services only from regional centers. And we will be able to compare the race and ethnicity of the general population of the state to our consumer caseload. In subsequent years, annual reports will update the basic disparities data and then add some additional in-depth explorations of critical issues.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name is Amy Westling. I'm from the Association of Regional Center Agencies. First and foremost, I want to echo Director Bargeman's thanks to the committee and staff and for all the people who came here to talk about this essential issue. We know that service disparities exist not just in the regional center system, but throughout health and human services programs, including special education, in-home supportive services, Medi-Cal, SSI, and mental health. That's not to make an excuse. It's to point out that it's a problem that's much larger than just our service system. But we're pleased that everyone has gathered here today to talk about this issue and how it impacts those served and supported by regional centers. What we see in other health and human services agencies' programs is that there is significant challenge in getting people in the front door. We see less of that in the regional center system, which means the outreach is working fairly well for most populations. But it's critical that we examine the issue of whether people's needs are being met through a combination of services available to them. The goal of regional centers is the service provision and meeting of people's needs for individuals with developmental disabilities and their families. As the chair mentioned, they were intentionally created to be nonprofit agencies, and the benefit of that is that they are responsive not just to the Department of Developmental Services, but also to their local communities. We know that there's certain things that drive disparity. We know that certain populations have a distrust of government, and that people have a challenge in discriminating a regional center from a government agency. We know that that distrust of government has grown significantly in recent months because of issues at the federal level. We also know that there are differing attitudes among various racial and ethnic groups about disability, and also the private versus public role in meeting the needs associated with it. We also know that challenges associated not with race and ethnicity, but with differing levels of socioeconomic status also drive some of these differences. For instance, individuals who are facing housing or food insecurity oftentimes have difficulty prioritizing the developmental needs of their child over those concerns. We know that parents with difficult work schedules or who maybe are working multiple jobs also face similar challenges. As Dr. Lovell mentioned, the data that regional centers have been collecting tells a piece of the story, but there's other pieces that are missing, and those are the things that we need to explore further. One piece is that the data that's available tells only what regional centers are purchasing for individuals. Regional centers are required to seek services from other generic agencies, such as schools and Social Security and Medi-Cal and private insurance before they purchase services. The available data doesn't tell us the whole breadth of things that's being purchased for an individual, only those things that regional centers are funding when there's no other service available. The available data doesn't allow us to break out things that are purchased through a contract with a vendor, such as transportation and some supported employment services. So even though an individual may be receiving those services, they won't appear in the data. We also are concerned and want to talk a little bit about individuals for whom the regional center isn't purchasing any services. It's important to note that the core mission of the regional center is service coordination, ensuring that an individual's needs are met across his or her lifespan. Individuals who have no services purchased from them through the regional center still receive the critical support of service coordination, and they continue to rely on that service, and they continue to choose to have that person, their service coordinator in their lives, to help them to navigate other complex systems, such as Social Security and Medi-Cal. Dr. Lovell did a fantastic job explaining the impact that living arrangements have on purchase of service utilization. And we know that individuals from diverse communities are much more likely to remain at home as adults than individuals who are Caucasian. There are some other things that we need to consider, such as systemic barriers. Services to support families who are supporting individuals at home were cut in 2009. things like camp and social recreation opportunities, as well as there was a cap put on respite. Additionally, in 2011, the federal government provided instructions that the state was no longer to pay families directly for services. And if they did, the federal government would no longer contribute to the cost of those services. Many of the families that were receiving respite services were doing it through an informal network that they had developed themselves. And this change at the federal level required that this process become much more formalized, and that the caregivers that they selected, whom they chose and whom they trusted, would go through formalized training, background checks, screenings, and it made the system much less nimble for them. A lot of work has been done in the last 5 years. As Director Bargeman noted, the Promotora model out of Frank D. Lannerman Regional Center used two community members who were known entities in their communities. They spoke Spanish, and they were trusted among the Spanish-speaking individuals who reside in that area. They each worked with 26 individuals and worked to meet them where they were, worked to help them to address things like housing and food insecurity so that they could focus on their child's disability, help them to develop self-advocacy skills so that they knew how to better access and navigate systems. This was a tremendously successful model, but there's been other good work done as well. Both Golden Gate Regional Center and San Andreas Regional Center worked with Stanford University to explore different options for how to meet the needs of various communities. First, by identifying what are those barriers, what are their perceptions that may be blocking people before they access the services they need, and then coming up with creative solutions for addressing those. Regional Center of Orange County works with English, Spanish, and Vietnamese language newspapers to make sure that they get the word out about meetings that they're having on important topics. And there's been some good information that's come out of the annual meetings that each regional center holds as well. For example, San Gabriel Pomona Regional Center heard from their Spanish-speaking community that they were accessing less respite than they were authorized because they couldn't schedule respite providers within a timely way, and their monthly respite allocations would expire. So San Gabriel Pomona Regional Center changed their authorizations to quarterly to make those services more usable and more friendly to the intended audience. I could go on and on about various examples, but I did want to touch on the additional work that's being done as a result of the special session last year. Director Bargeman spoke of the cultural specialists that regional centers are in the process of hiring. And there's many projects underway that are being tried to see what is it that will work, because there's nothing like testing something in the field. For example, are there ways to address families maybe forgetting appointments? And so Frank D. Lannerman Regional Center is working with other regional centers to develop an automated phone system that's multilingual to provide information for families. Another regional center, Inland Regional Center, is working to provide parent training specifically for people who aren't accessing regional center paid supports. And they're using a known community entity to do that. So overall, I just wanted to share these things that have been done, and while recognizing that there's more work to be done, provide some assurance to the committee that the regional center system takes these issues very seriously and looks forward to continuing to address them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, we'll now move to our second panel regarding how we ensure cultural competency and identifying systemic barriers. Our panelists are Arriva Martin, Dr. April Lopez, Abner Antunez, Tian Nguyen, and Marty Omoto. And since we do have since we do have multiple panels with a number of people in each, if it would be possible to keep your remarks to about 5 minutes, that would be ideal, just so we can move through efficiently and get the public comment as well. So I would appreciate that. Great. You can go in any order you would like.
Good afternoon, Senator Wiener. Thank you for convening this very important hearing. My name is Areva Martin, and I am a civil rights attorney, and I'm the founder and president of Special Needs Network, a 501c3 nonprofit organization I started over 11 years ago, shortly after my own son, Marty, was diagnosed with autism. Special Needs Network has offices in Los Angeles and Compton, California. In the 11 years since we started, we have served more than 40,000 families who have kids and adults with autism and other developmental disabilities, most of whom are African-American and Latino families. Most of the families we serve live at or below the poverty line. Many work 2 or 3 jobs, and they have 3 or 4 children. They represent the thousands of families each year that suffer from a state-funded program that consistently spends less on their children than on white kids in more affluent parts of the state. And there may be disagreement about why these disparities exist, but it is undeniable that the Department of Developmental Services and the 21 regional centers' facially neutral funding scheme is discriminatory in its application and effect. And it has been so for over 2 decades. And this, Senator, is reprehensible. Over the last decade, I've been a member, and I've played a key role on almost every task force convened by this legislative body, dating back to the 2005 Blue Ribbon Commission on Autism, convened by then Speaker Fabian Nunes. That report that was issued as a result of that Blue Ribbon Commission found that minority and poor children who have disabilities in the state of California bear an additional burden. In fact, that burden dates back to 1992, almost 2 decades ago. It was confirmed in 1992 that disparities exist in the spending on kids of color in the regional center system. The 2011 LA Times article revealed those shocking disparities in the regional center funding. UC Davis study, some 6 years later, repeats the same disparities. We've seen it in a state audit that was issued last year by Betty Yee. We've seen it recently in a public counsel report that will be coming out in March of this year. Report after report confirms that this state spends less on children of color. I sat here almost 5 years ago to the day and testify before a hearing about these disparities. I watched then Director of the Developmental Disabilities, Terry Delgadillo, give her testimony. She testified that the disparities that exist in the regional center services was based on an antiquated budgeting process that favored providing the same level of funding for those regional centers based on their historical spending. Terry Delgadillo confirmed that for smaller regional centers, those that have larger populations of African American and Latino children, it would be almost impossible for them to ever provide equitable funding based on the budget process that's used by the regional center. At the hearing with Terry Delgadillo and those of us from the autism community, Steinberg convened an equity and diversity task force. I co-chaired, had the honor of co-chairing that task force. We met for a year. We met with the legislators. We met with members of DDS. We met with the advocate community. We made recommendations about changing the budget process and changing the way the POS dollars are spent, to be more transparent and to provide for the immediate elimination of disparities based on race and ethnicity, to provide for a system that funded the care for kids and adults in the system based on their needs and not their race. Those recommendations, as I sit here today and testify, have not been implemented by the Department of Developmental Services. So it's a little shocking to me, frustrating, and quite frankly offensive when I hear officials from the state talk about needing more time. Families in the autism community, we have waited long enough. We have written thousands and thousands of letters to legislators. We have spent, I can't tell you how many hours traveling from Los Angeles and all parts of the states to Sacramento. We've marched, we've rallied, we've passed numerous pieces of legislation, but yet the disparities persist. I don't know what it's going to take for the state of California that prides itself on providing care for kids who have autism in an equitable way to finally eliminate these disparities. In concert with public counsel, we submitted some recommendations to address some of the issues, and some of those recommendations include eliminating parent participation requirements that often prevent families from receiving early intervention services, requiring the regional centers to provide a comprehensive list of all services provided by the regional centers before the IPP process, reinstating the respite and recreational services that you heard about earlier that disproportionately impact poor families, requiring DDS to reallocate some of the $11 million that you heard talked about today so that a large portion of that money goes to nonprofit organizations working to end disparities. And lastly, I think what's most important is establishing an independent body to develop a budget process that ensures that funding is based on client needs and not ethnicity and race. A body that doesn't work within the DDS system, because we've heard for years that DDS, for whatever reason, can't get this right. We're also calling for a study to look at the impact of these inequities on families to determine if policy or financial remuneration is warranted based on these continued disparities. I'll close by saying today is the day. Dr. Martin Luther King said it most eloquently when he stated, "The time is always right to do the right thing." Today is the day to do the right thing, to end the discriminatory practices of DDS, and to stand with families and to give each child in the state of California with a developmental disability the opportunity that he or she needs to reach their highest potential, irrespective of their race or their zip code. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Lopez?
Thank you very much. And thank you for the opportunity to be here today to speak. I'm April Lopez, the chair of the State Council on Developmental Disabilities. I'm also part of the Legislative and Public Policy Committee, and I'm the chair of the Statewide Self-Determination Committee. I also happen to be the chair of the CAC, which is a community advisory committee for the Placentia Yorba Linda School District. So I get to hear it at the elementary school level as well as once they leave high school. We all recognize that we are a majority state, and so those numbers have been given. I think one of the biggest problems in the community is that consumers don't know what to ask for. And I like to use this example when I'm out and about, because sometimes if you haven't been, we're all fighting for our disability community, but some of us have never had the privilege of working in the regional center system. I have three children, and my daughter Isabella, who's now 14, has a dual diagnosis. She's autistic and she has Down syndrome. So I've been living it for 14 years, and I like to use this as an example of, you go into a restaurant because you're hungry, and you say you're hungry, what do you want? What do you have? Well, what do you want? Well, I want pizza. Well, we don't have pizza. Okay, well, do you have tacos? No, we don't have tacos. So there's no menu. And so if you don't have a menu, and don't get me wrong, I don't believe that we should live within that box. We need to think outside the box. So I believe that there should be a list. And we at the State Council right now are currently working on a list of the services so that it can also be in the languages and the threshold languages. We should have our list compiled, at least in Spanish-speaking, by September. So most of the cultures, in most cultures, people take the person that's speaking, that's in charge, for their word. And they go away at that point, like we did 14 years ago. When we receive an NOA, which is the notice of action, and they give us our rights, you know, due process, there's socioeconomic that have a big, huge decision in that. Do I want to have an ulcer that year? Do I want to create pain with the family? Because it's quite stressful. Oftentimes, the regional center will lead you to believe that everything is satisfactory because it is documented on the OHH form that it's satisfactory. So if you don't go beyond, then it doesn't appear that anybody is in dispute or has any issues with the services that they're receiving or not receiving. There's great disparities across regional center due to cultural ethnicities, and also there's geographical issues. I want to tell just two short stories really quick, because I know we're limited on time, but I think stories are important. Many of you know who Senator Emerson is, and I'm in Orange County, and I go to the self-determination meetings because I sit on that advisory committee. And he called me up one day and said, I need you to talk to a friend of mine who is another doctor in the area, has a successful practice, he and his wife, and if you can give him some resources, because he has a child that is in a day program through the regional center. And I said I would. So he came over to the meeting, and he spoke to me and said that oftentimes when his son is in this day program, that they will leave early and bring him home as early as an hour from the day program. And he and his wife, who have a very successful practice, and they are from India, and are reluctant to say anything because of the fear that there will be retaliation, because apparently if you say something, they could change you or take you out of that program and put you into a different program. And they had been in so many programs already that were not good, and it had already happened. And so they could be in the middle of their job and have to leave and be home for someone to receive his son. So I put him in contact with someone. So I guess my point to this story is someone like myself, who I've never been described as being shy, someone who feels more confident to reach out to people to have help, are still feeling this sense of fear that there might be some retaliation, or they can't speak up because changes won't be made, and it interferes with even working parents. I tell you another story real quick about a friend who is a Cuban woman who's afraid of authority and who receives a denial of services, the NOA. She understands that she receives something that says due process, and you have what your rights are, informal actions, seeing a judge. These are all culturally, there's, you know, advocating is costly, socioeconomics is an issue, and needless to say, the list goes on and on. And I'll tell you my last story. Most know I'm a chiropractor, and I've been in practice for 20 years, and I had a patient come in that was sent over by her primary doctor because she had back pain because she was lifting her child now that's 10 years old, because he has to have an enema 3 to 4 times a day, and he's already 10, and she's been lifting him and moving him for several years. Doctor says you can't keep doing it. And I explained to her, well, don't you know what regional center is? Have you reached out? Yes, she has 15 hours of regional care hours. And so But they haven't found anybody for me, and it's been a year now, and I'm still calling. So, of course, I call and try to help her out, and they gave her 30 more hours. My point to this is Vietnamese woman, she did not want me to call and ask because she was more afraid of the caseworker getting in trouble, and I had to convince her that she wasn't going to get in trouble. There's maybe a language barrier. She just felt like this is, you know, if they don't have anyone, they'll call her, and she's been waiting a year. The additional hours isn't going to make a difference if you don't have a nurse there to help. And she was not aware that she could have a family member that could be trained so they could help her because they didn't have anyone. There's also a 6-year-old boy that was a brother of the 10-year-old. And he asked his mom, how come we never get to go on vacation? So she's telling me these stories, and I say, well, there's services that you can get. Again, we're back to not that they weren't available to this family, but the family wasn't aware that they were available to her. So, and then closing, I'll tell you my story of 3 weeks ago, maybe 4 weeks ago, where I had two individuals come to my office because I myself was asking for some additional services, and I wasn't sure how the system worked. So they came to my office with respite, as I have a daughter that's entering puberty, and it's quite difficult, as it is probably for any child that doesn't have a disability. It's been pretty crazy. And so I had two people come to my office, and one nurse sat there and explained to me and said to me, what do I want? And I said, well, you know, I filled out this paperwork, and she explained to me what my responsibility was as a parent. So my smiles went immediately. I was frustrated, and I said, you don't need to tell me what my rights are, what my responsibility is as a parent. I have been living it for 14 years. And I expressed myself. I'm sure not all parents were in a position to sit there in front of two people and felt comfortable enough to do that. So, and needless to say, I said, I think this meeting is over, and it ended. So I thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. There's plenty of stories. I think we at the State Council and Developmental Disabilities are doing as much as we can, and we will continue to fight on this path. And thank you for giving us the opportunity to be here today.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. We'll now go to Abner Atunes. And again, if I could, if it would be possible to keep remarks within about 5 minutes, that would be great. We do have a number of additional panelists and then public speakers. I want to make sure people can stay and participate. So I appreciate everyone's feedback.
Okay. Good afternoon, senators. Thank you very much for the invite. My name is Abner Atunes, and I'm a father of a 9-year-old kid who was diagnosed with under the spectrum. His name is also Abner. He's Junior. He was diagnosed when he was 2.5 and became a client of South Central of Los Angeles Regional Center. We were told at the time that the regional center was the light. We blindly believed that they would have the answers from the very beginning. Instead of being supportive and helpful, they were intimidating and blocking our very request. We asked many times by phone, by email, and in person for different therapies for our son, but we couldn't get an answer. We waited 1.5 years for that. You might know that early intervention is critical for children with autism and other disabilities. Every day you wait for services puts your child another day behind. I ask you, senators, if your child was diagnosed at the age of 2.5 with autism, would you want to wait 1.5 years before getting them help? Others face similar problems, some of them here today. Roberto has received very few services from South Central Regional Center. Last year, Roberto turned 22 and was required to exit the school system, meaning the regional center takes over providing his supports. Roberto has nonverbal autism and can be self-injurious, as aggressive and aggressive at times. The day programs at the regional center offered said they couldn't handle him. So he has stayed home for 9 months. His mom called and emailed over 25 times and begged even the top executive to call her back. But nothing happened. Finally, 11 days ago, Roberto's mom showed up at the town hall meeting at South Central Regional Center and told her story publicly. 3 days later, Roberto was offered a program that she hopes is more appropriate. Why did it take showing at a public forum to get services that Roberto is entitled to, we ask? Jared lives in Long Beach and is a client of Harbor Regional Center. He was born with a rare disorder called Dandy-Walker syndrome, which affects his brain and causes intellectual disabilities, severe autism, partial blindness, hearing loss, and motor difficulties. Jared is now 16 and has received very few regional center services over his life, despite his intense needs and his mother's consistent request for help. Jared now has a severe behavioral challenges and bites himself regularly because he has no way to communicate. Jared is eligible for regional center funded behavior therapy, and his mother has desperately requested direct intervention for him for 5 years through over 100 emails and phone calls. Jared was finally approved, but now the regional center says there is no behavior provider that has availability. This waiting has put a tremendous strain on Jared's dedicated mother, Myra, a single mom who, despite speaking only Spanish, has been a fierce advocate for her son. She drove up to Sacramento today, starting out at 3 a.m. with dozens of other parents who want their voices to be heard. Myra, could you please stand up? As you can tell from our stories, the most common tactic at the regional center is not to respond or request. Mostly, they don't call us back or return our emails, or they say that they're working on it. We don't usually get denied a service. And if we finally do get denied, the regional center knows that we can't afford to go to due process. Another major problem is my community feels intimidated by the regional center staff. We are parents who are devastated by the diagnosis of our child. But the regional center knows that some of us are low income, don't speak English well, and lack of a formal education. And then we face people with master's degrees, PhDs, and they use their position against us. While many of the regional center staffs are very nice, too many treat us in a condescending or disrespectful way. One parent said that the psychologist who came to evaluate her son took only 15 minutes with him. And at one point that time, posted someone on Facebook. Another parent said her service coordinator told her that he can't trust parents because many parents lie. Some regional center employees whose salaries are paid by taxpayer dollars act like they are doing us a favor when they help us. They say, we're just human. Please be patient. But my son is human, and we can't wait any longer. Who is holding the regional centers accountable? There seems to be no one to grade them. Their leaders know their system. They know that no one is going to question them. The only one who will question them is DDS, and they always seem to give them a passing grade. No offense. Its regional center has a board of directors made up mostly parents and consumers that are supposed to hold their executive director accountable. They are usually controlled by executive director staff. They don't provide true oversight. Many Latino families may actually feel like they are being held by the regional centers because they don't know better. It is like we are starving and they give us a little piece of candy and we think we're being helped. But we haven't even given the whole menu. We don't know what else could be there. We have to find out things ourselves. Nothing is provided unless we ask for it. And even then, it is a battle. Recently, the California legislature and DDS have provided $11 million to regional centers to help reduce the ethnic and racial disparities. Many of us have concerns about how this money is being spent. Many regional centers have said that they will spend some of their grant on translation services, but they should already be providing translation at all of the public meetings and shouldn't be using the new money for this. Just in the past week, however, many consumers in South Central Regional Center, including my son, Avner, have received letters saying that the regional center is paying $200 as part of their services for their parents to have translation at a public town hall meeting and board meetings. This means that it will look like our children have gotten $200 of direct services, but in fact, all of the regional center did is provide translation that they should have been provided anyways. This is one sneaky way to use their grant and close the disparity gap. And they think we wouldn't notice. Also, many regional centers are using the $11 million you gave them to train parents to help other parents navigate the system. I think it's a great idea to have parents help parents. Believe me, that's often the only way we know about it, because regional centers usually tell us nothing. The problem with these navigators is that they are being told what to do and say by the regional centers or a group who is getting paid by the regional center. We don't trust them because they aren't independent. We want to be in control. We want our children to have more choices, choices that are familiar to our culture and also to our community. Many of us are pushing for the self-determination law to take effect because we know this means that we will have more control and regional centers can't keep saying no to us. But senators, we cannot do this alone. Please help us by holding the regional centers accountable. Give the parents more respect and control. Give us the power that right now belongs only to the highly paid executives at the regional centers. They may have PhDs in their fields, but we have PhDs in our children. Once again, thank you very much for your time and allowing me to speak today.
Thank you very much.
I try to give you 5 minutes, maybe a little long, but I try to short as I can. Good afternoon. Let me introduce myself. My name is Ding Nguyen. I have a sister. Her name is Trang, and she was diagnosed in Vietnam as cerebral palsy when she was 5, and now she's 39 years old. My sister uses a wheelchair and needs help to move around. So she has become the consumer of regional center since she was 16 when she just came here. So I'm also volunteering as a secretary of Vietnamese Parents with Disabled Children Association, short name is VPDCA, which has more than 200 members in Los Angeles and Orange Counties. I am here today to represent both my sister and the people of VPDCA to present the committee some difficulties and issues that we Vietnamese parents, families experience trying to get the regional center services. The first thing I want to talk about is the most common problem that our family encounter is that they don't know what services are viable and useful. sometimes we don't know what the services are viable and useful for our families. Also, sometimes the service coordinators don't tell us what services are viable and we can get, and that can help us. And also, and if they, if we don't know all the differences different in the services that are viable, then we don't know what to ask for, even if the regional center asks us what we want. So what can help us is if the service coordinator gets better training about the different services so that they can tell us about it and then help us identify them for the, our families. Also, if they can give us the information about different services that are available in Vietnamese language so that we can read and understand it and so that we can have the better make a choice. If before like home visits, the service coordinator can study the family's case so that they can think and research what services the regional center can offer to the family. The second point I want to talk here is our families have not gotten information on what the IPP is, what our rights are, and how we should be involved in the planning process. Sometimes when the regional center call us to schedule a meeting, and they don't tell us it is an IPP meeting. So that is that a lot of families don't know even know what IPP is. A lot of families know about IEP, but not much about IPP. So they don't understand, don't know what the rights are, and then don't know why the IPP is important. Sometimes a family don't even know whether they have a copy of the IPP document because they don't know what it is. The regional center can help us if they mention that in the meeting is IPP, and also explain what important IPP is, and also let our families know that they have the right to have IPP meeting in Vietnamese and also the document in Vietnamese. So a lot of Vietnamese families don't know about that. So the third point I want to talk to here is in our culture, sometimes it is not comfortable for us to speak out, to speak up for something that we would like or question when the services are denied. Sometimes when services are denied, the regional centers don't tell us why they deny it. Sometimes they just say, they just told us that, say no. And as a culture, you know, then we just accept it. Because we were told no, we might not ask again for it, even though we might really need it for that service from our kids or our children. It is not comfortable in our culture to challenge what the regional center say because we think that they know what they are doing. So we think that the regional center can help our family when they say no. They should give us explanation why and tell us what our rights are. That can help us understand. Also, sometimes when we get the service provider that we don't trust or feel that they are not helping us, we are likely to give up the services because without knowing that we can ask for help from the regional center. The regional center can help the family by letting the family know that if the service provider doesn't work out, they can find the help from the regional center to find another service provider. That way, we don't stop using the services because we still need it. If the regional center can do that, it will help our family a lot. The fourth point in here I want to talk is what services are being denied. This one I just give you some brief example, not a lot. First thing is special education. Sometimes we don't know what services children can get from the regional center when they are school age. For example, I know that a family with a child that has a lot of behavior problems at home, but the family didn't know what to do, and it caused a lot of stress for the family. This family doesn't even know what IPP is, so of course they don't even know what to ask for. Maybe the regional center can help explain to the family what services they can get maybe in the home or on the weekends that will help the family to overcome the difficult situation. For the health, for example, it's, physical therapy, it's very hard to get the service based on the parents' insurance. In the insurance usually doesn't cover it, and it's very rare for the regional center to get involved into it. Some, the same with the Medicare too. So we really need the regional center to help us to get those needed services. Another example is a leg brace from my sister. She needs a leg brace to help her to stand up. So she got it paid by CCS when she was still under 18, but now she rolled up and taller, and then that not fit anymore to her. So she needs a new one, but the regional center refers to insurance, and the insurance won't pay for it. And we end up, like, right now she doesn't have anything, so she cannot stand well by herself, you know, I mean, to stand up without braces. Another example is for my sister also is the wheelchair broken about a few years ago, a couple of years ago. At that point, the tuition center refer us to the Medi-Cal, but Medi-Cal doesn't give us like every 7 years to get a new wheelchair, so we end up to pay it by our own, but the wheelchair is not very comfortable for her because, you know, we don't have much money to pay for the expensive car, like wheelchair that can fit to her. And in some, in other issue, you know, regional center has working workshops, but most likely happen in during the weekday that most parents working. So they cannot come to attend the meeting. So if it will be help to us for us that if they can have the meeting in the weekend or we may weeknights, so the parents can come to attend. And also the note is sent to us maybe in our language, Vietnamese, so that the parents can understand, read it and understand about it. So in the summary that our Vietnamese family help the regional center understand our culture better, so we can work together to help our children get the services they need. They do some work, but they need more work to be done. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, now our final speaker on the panel.
Marty Yamoto, California Disability Senior Community Action Network and the California Person-Centered Advocacy Partnership. More important of all, I was a family member. My older sister, Elena, had developmental disabilities, and she passed away about 14 years ago. Just want to explain to everyone here, it may seem that we're trying to divide, or there's a division within our community, and there is anger, and there is a division right now. And I think the whole reason for this hearing that you're trying to do is to bridge that division. But the anger is real, and my own family felt that when my sister was alive, and especially her last 10 years or so, or even before that, when we're fighting for services and we kept hitting barriers one time after another, and then you realize the enemy, you know, to everything you're fighting for are those barriers, but it's also time. And every one of these parents and families are fighting not just against barriers, they're fighting time. Because their children are getting older, or if they're becoming adults, they become fragile because of health needs and because they don't get the right services. And we lost that battle. And, you know, you try to find the time to fight, and then you try to find the time to cry and to be angry. And then you find the time also to be hopeful because there's so much hope and joy with my older sister or their sons and daughters or siblings, all of us. But I think saying all that, I've always realized that there's good people everywhere. There's good people who are working in the regional centers, good people working in the department, here in the legislature, good providers, good families. And I guess what we're asking for, ultimately, from all of you and from all of us, is that we're not looking for a civil war. And we're not looking for a truce, not looking for a treaty. We're looking for a union that works with all the families, with the regional centers, with the providers, with everybody. And there's a couple of things that we need to do. And that can only happen with good oversight. And so this hearing is maybe the first step towards that, but it can't be the only step, and we can't see you 5 years from now. And the legislature needs to step up too, as well as all of us. There's some barriers, and I want to identify. As Amy Westling mentioned, the problem is much larger than just the regional centers. And the reason I agree with that is because we need to look at the problem systemically, that it crosses the silos of services that our families access, or people with developmental disabilities access. And that's important, because to try to solve a problem, we need to really understand what the problem is. And also, there's solutions that other systems are putting forward. But as she said, you know, the problems exist in special ed, Medi-Cal, and IHSS. I know that from firsthand experience. Number two, there's a lack of consistent oversight and accountability. That is crucial by the legislature in budget hearings, but also in policy committees like this, by the state, meaning the Department of Developmental Services and other state agencies, by the regional centers, but also oversight and advocacy and accountability by providers and advocates groups too. We need to do a better job. And also, I've worked with minority or civil rights groups who deal with communities of color, and they need to step up and push for the right things to happen in all the communities of color. And they're not doing it. We're not part of their agenda, meaning people with disabilities. Number three, there needs to be better information and more outreach by the state at all levels, including the Department of Developmental Disabilities, and posting important notices in languages, at least the threshold languages, that Medi-Cal uses, so that information is out there for people to access. And I have proven from my own work that getting good information out there can bring people together. I've done that on my own for the last 17 years, and certainly the state can step up and do that too. They've made inroads, but they can do a better job. Number four, efforts. One of the problems, I think, is that we do these efforts towards reducing disparities, which is great, but they're often segregated from the mainstream of other things that we do, meaning we have our normal programs and services, and then we have these additional programs or services meant to reduce disparities. And I think one of the problems with that is it really doesn't touch upon the things that we need to do in terms of reducing disparities in those mainstream programs, such as competitive integrated employment, housing, supported living, and other needed services. Number five, there's an unmet need. There's a lack of providers and a lack of good services that people need, especially from communities of color that are not out there. And lastly, there's funding, which you're going to hear from all types of groups for all types of problems. But this one is especially true. Some recommendations, as I mentioned before, outreach needs to be better. Post notices in language, threshold languages. And most importantly, there was grants issued to reduce disparities through the regional centers, which I thought was a good thing, except we need to get the Department of Developmental Services to post the entire proposals that they approved on their website so everyone can see them, because you can't have good accountability and oversight if you don't know exactly what goals and outcomes were approved to reduce disparities. And again, it's a partnership. It's a union. We need to start working together. Number three, continue the dashboard on the developmental Department of Developmental Services website. It's a regional center oversight dashboard. It's great. We need to make sure that continues with good information. Number four, incorporate, as I mentioned before, all the efforts towards reducing disparities in the things that we normally are doing within developmental services, such as making sure that the issue of disparities is addressed as we're moving forward on person-centered planning, person-centered thinking, that towards efforts to comply with the Home and Community-Based Services final rule, that disparities, that issue is built in, that the issues of reducing the disparities is part of self-determination, part of the community placement plan expansion, part of other systems such as the whole person care pilot program that is administered by the Department of Healthcare Services, housing, transportation. Number five, target unmet need and where services are not being met in communities of color by restarting something that was put away a long time ago, which was developing new resources, new program development in regional center catchment areas across the state. The state put a freeze on that, and we need to change the culture of thinking that this is important and this can help reduce disparities. Lastly, and there is no lastly, actually this list can go on, but at least for this hearing, my final point is, I think also, aside from the regional centers and the state needs to do a better job, and the legislature needs to do a better job too in oversight and accountability, providers and advocates need to do a better job too. We need to mobilize our communities, and not just the advocates who represent or work with communities of color. The other advocates too need to be looking at these issues as they own it too. Providers need to own this issue too. Ultimately, it's the responsibility of our entire community. Again, we want a union, not a civil war. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all of you. If I could just note, we do have a rule in the legislature asking people not to make audible either applause or booing. If you like something, do a thumbs up. If you don't like it, do a thumbs down or do jazz fingers. It's there's a lot of things you can do. I just do have one quick, Ms. Martin, just one quick question. You had mentioned that the task force had proposed a number of different ways of doing the budget. If you could just briefly sort of, you don't have to describe all the recommendations, but is it your belief that implementing those budget changes would significantly improve the situation?
I think what came out of the task force that Senator Steinberg convened were two things, that the problem that exists with DDS and regional centers has a macro and a micro component. And at the macro level is this budgeting process that favors regional centers that have high POS budgets. So if you've been getting hypothetically $200 million per year in your POS budget, that's the amount that you continue to get. So it looks at your budget historically, and those numbers continue. So if you've been a regional center that's been spending less, it's hard for you then to break out of that historical cycle. So at the macro level, the budgeting process is flawed, and that's what Terry Delgadillo acknowledged when she testified at a similar hearing 5 years ago and said that there was going to be a process to change that budgeting process. And to my knowledge, that has not been done. So that was one of the recommendations of the task force, was to just blow up that budgeting process, start over, and make it so that it would not favor those regional centers, because in some ways you're rewarding regional centers even if they have disparities. And then at the micro level, there are the things we heard about that are happening at individual regional centers, the lack of respect, the lack of accountability, the case managers not being responsive to families. I think as Ebner so eloquently stated about internally. So we have both this macro issue and the micro issue. And the micro issue is compounded by the lack of accountability. And I just want to comment briefly on what the DDS director said about going around to the hearings that she participated in. So the comments made by these parents, 10 hours of that at each of those meetings. I mean, literally, you could just fill a room with parents that would have very similar complaints about their individual regional centers. So the question for us as advocates become, what happens to that? So what happens with the complaints that we just heard about at these individual regional centers? And it appears from, again, I've been at this 10 years, the accountability level at the DDS level just seems to be lacking. So what happens when a letter goes out that says we're spending $200 to translate for you, something that should have already been translated for you, and we're spending that as a part of this extra money, this $11 million? What happens with that complaint? Does it go into a deep, dark hole and nothing ever gets done?
And I think that's the level of frustration. And I love Marty, and I agree with some of what he said, but I don't agree with this concept of unity, because we come here and we testify and we try. We have tried to do this in the most amicable, peaceful, collective, collaborative way possible, but we're not getting anywhere. We're back here with the same complaints over and over again. So I'm at the point saying, no, it's not working. We got to blow the system up. The system is fundamentally flawed. And how many more reports do we need? How many more hearings do we need to tell you? And how many more excuses can we hear from the state that's responsible for this that they can't fix it? I just can't believe intellectually that we can't fix this. This is a problem that is fixable. It is not a problem that should persist for two decades. My son was 2 years old when I started on this journey. My son's now about to graduate from high school. Do I have to come back here when he's now a fully grown man to talk about these same issues? That's not fair. And I happen to be capable of doing this because I am a lawyer. I am an advocate. I run a nonprofit. But what about the families that don't have those resources, don't have the educational level, don't even have the resources to get to Sacramento from Los Angeles or Fresno or other parts of the state? And that's the frustration that you hear. And I know you're a HLS graduate, so am I. So I know you understand what this is all about. And I know that you appreciate that we cannot go on one day longer with this system impacting in a disproportionate, discriminatory way that it does families of color.
Thank you. Thank you to all the panelists.
Thank you.
And thank you to the jazz hands. Okay, we'll now call up our final panel to identify best practices and formalizing next steps. We have Gloria Wong, Barbara Wheeler, Catherine Blakemore, and then Ms. Wessling and Ms. Bargman will ask back up to, yeah. Whichever, start with Ms. Wong.
Thank you very much, Senator Wiener and committee members. Appreciate the opportunity to brief you from a perspective of a regional center. Difficult information that we need to process, but things that are important for all of us to hear and learn from. But I can speak to you only from Eastern Los Angeles Regional Center. So thank you for the opportunity and privilege to present on this very important matter and to reflect on efforts to improve disparities among the various ethnic groups and the future paths to continue to pave the way towards equity across the various ethnic groups. I think it's appropriate that as I've been asked to present on this subject, we're a unique regional center in that our demographics, our profile is such that it does speak to the issue of the ethnic groups. We have 71% of our population is Hispanic, 12.5% is Asian, so we have about 83% that is of the Asian and Hispanic culture. Our white Caucasian families make up 10%, very small number. So certainly I think the issue that has been discussed about the disparity and the variances on the per capita expenditures certainly do play a role when you look at our numbers. For East LA Regional Center, you do have, if you look at the numbers for our white Caucasian families, there is a large disparity, undoubtedly, when you just look at the numbers between the Hispanic and Asians. For our regional center, what we have been able to certainly determine, and I think you've heard this through various other panels, for us, residential plays a large factor in terms of those figures. When we as a regional center isolate out the residential cost, we do drop off those differences substantially, and they're about maybe a $2,000 or $3,000 difference. It's still a disparity, but it is closer and narrower when you isolate out the residential factor. Nevertheless, there is the need for us to focus on those differences and what it is that we need to do as an agency to close that gap. And I can only speak to you as a regional center what it is that we have done that we do think has made the effort. And if I look at our numbers and over a five-year period that we have been doing the POS data recording, we have noticed when I look at our per capita authorization, we have had a growth factor from 11-12 to now for our Hispanics at East LA Regional Center and our Asian families. The per capita has gone up for our Hispanic families about 7% when you look at the per capita authorization. And for the Asian families, it's about 6%. Now, what you do have is our white Caucasian families. They also go up in double numbers. But we've made efforts. We have gained baby steps. The efforts that we have put forth have been, as we've learned from our community, our effort has been grassroots. Eastern Los Angeles Regional Center has worked very closely with our community, particularly, and I think you've heard it through part of the testimony, Fiesta Educativa. It's been around for many, many years, and it is a parent association, that a grassroots effort that has now become statewide, that started within our regional center, and we work very closely with to do presentations, to learn from our families, in addition to another group that you will hear from our Asian communities called the Chinese Parent Association Group. Those two groups are essential for us at Eastern Los Angeles Regional Center to collaborate with them and to move forward on projects that will advance the disparity issues. So we have done a variety of training efforts. I know Dr. Wheeler is here, and she's been party to much of the efforts that we have undertaken. So I know you'll hear more about that. But I will tell you that one of the things that we're most excited about, much of which you have already heard much about, the $11 million. Whatever effort we have exercised at Eastern Los Angeles Regional Center, there will be no comparison to what we can do with the $11 million. We are just getting underway in putting forth this effort. For us, really the centerpiece of our plan has to do with what we call enhanced caseload ratio. And we are focusing on a reduced caseload ratio of 1 to 40, which will concentrate on our lowest per capita families, 200 cases. We are just in the transition form right now to do that. There will be four service coordinators that are Spanish-speaking. One will focus on our Asian caseload, 40 cases. And additionally, we have added person-centered planners. We think it's essential because 200 is such a small number, but it's a starting point for us. But with the person-centered coordinators that we have added, we want to impact our intake division so that as families are coming in, they're being walked through what is a complicated system and learn what the IPP, getting prepared for that initial meeting with their service coordinator, and that additionally we want to make sure that these person-centered coordinators are also working with our other service coordinators. So we want to maximize the effort. I would imagine that 1 year from now, when we have instituted this plan, we will have all of the information, the data that will come in, quantitative, qualitative data that we can share with you, and what I am certainly hoping will be continued strides and improvement towards minimizing the disparities.
And do you have, in terms of explaining why there's been at least at an aggregate level and, you know, no real movement in the last 5 years overall? I know, I'm sure there are differences among centers and so forth, so... But do you have any thoughts on why that persists and why it hasn't changed much?
I think one of the things that you've heard repeated, and we hear it consistently at our meetings, our regional center, the families, and again, 82% that are Hispanic and Asian, very low level of residential placement, our most highest cost services. So what happens is if you're not using residential, what you're looking for is support systems. Support system that can keep your family together. That translates to the suspended services. I can't tell you how many times we have been asked by families, when can we get the camps? When can we get the social recreational services back in place? When can we increase? And we did. We rolled back respite hours. When you have our Hispanic families place residential placement, their total percentage is 3%. What they're relying on is this support system, this foundation. Those services, even though they are not extremely costly when you would compare it to residential, they're just essential services to family. So I would say if we can move with towards the effort of reenacting services such as that and exploring what other services these families want that are culturally relevant to them, then we can start to make effort.
When were those services cut?
That was in 2009.
So the bad years. It was just never restored.
They were never restored.
Okay. So there's been a disproportionate emphasis on the folks who are living not at home and as opposed to the services.
In those particular services, yeah. I would say those are critical. We hear that repeatedly from the Hispanic and Asian community.
Good afternoon. I'm Catherine Blakemore with Disability Rights California. We're a federally mandated legal services program for Californians with disabilities. We assisted over 25,000 individuals last year, and of that number, about 11,000 were individuals with intellectual or developmental disabilities, either through our federally funded services or through our Office of Clients' Rights Advocacy. A vast majority of the people that we represented were from traditionally underserved communities. That's a priority of our agency. So the stories that you heard today from families are stories that our staff help people resolve every day. But obviously, given the numbers and the resources we have to represent people, while we're successful in resolving those, there's thousands of other people who don't find their way to our services and therefore continue to face barriers. I want to spend just the time today looking at the recommendations we're making because I know we're running out of time and that is the focus of this panel. So on page 8 of our testimony is a series of recommendations that we have in about 4 different areas. And the areas are, first of all, increase oversight of service disparities and language access. I often say that we can't get someplace unless we set an outcome measure about where we're trying to get. And so asking the department and the regional centers and working with stakeholders to identify a specific target about what we are going to do in concrete and real terms to address the service disparities that we've talked about today. And then the specific steps we can all take to address those kinds of barriers, but knowing where we're going in a measurable kind of way. Similarly, I think effective evaluation of the services, particularly the $11 million and what's worked and what hasn't worked in terms of reducing disparities, should be expected by the legislature and should be expected by the communities that we serve. The second area I want to talk just briefly about is expand culturally competent services and eliminate service delivery barriers. Because in large part of the 2009 budget cuts and the changes to the service delivery system, I am really convinced we could not have designed something that was less likely to be friendly to low-income monolingual Spanish speakers, and the service system is now far beyond the initial intent of using regional centers to help families access services, but instead an agency that is required by law to tell people you have to go here and you have to go there and you are sort of on your own in many instances to resolve that. So agreeing with Ms. Wong, who said restore the services that were eliminated, that is long overdue. Those are the services that individuals from minority communities relied on, and it is something that would immediately make a difference in terms of reducing service disparities. I want to also add to that the notion of looking at culturally competent ways to provide respite services. A family that we are currently representing is Russian-speaking. There are 2 children in that family. Both children have autism. The mother was completely overwhelmed with caring for the children. Her mother, the grandmother, previously lived in a different home and provided respite service to the mom. Because of the difficulty the family was experiencing, the grandmother quit her job, moved into the home to help provide care for the children. And at that point, the regional center said, I'm sorry, you now live in the home and you can no longer, you are no longer eligible to provide respite services. You family need to go look someplace else to find a respite agency that will assist you. That just turns things on its head. This is a family who does not speak English, needs a language competent person to provide the respite service. There's trust issues with going outside of the family. So ensuring as we restore services that we have the flexibility to provide those services in a culturally competent way is really a critical component. Similarly, ensure flexibility for parent training components for applied behavioral analysis services. Some regional centers say you have to go to group training as a parent. Not all of those training classes are offered in languages that parents can understand. It requires families to give up additional valuable time on weekends to attend up to 8 hours of a training program. There is not actually that requirement in the law, but sometimes apparently we need to be more specific than we thought we were being at that the time when that was drafted. Identify new ways and new service models that individuals need and want. And that means meeting with members of the community to have those discussions. When that's been done, I think there's been creativity demonstrated about what families actually want. Meet with consumers and families to identify the barriers they specifically are experiencing, particularly when authorized services are not utilized. One regional center did that recently, talked to each family who was not utilizing the services that had been authorized in the IPP and was able to identify barriers such as, I don't have a way to get to that particular service, and regional center could then resolve that barrier. It is much akin to the model that Ms. Wong was talking about in terms of meeting with families and understanding and planning individually for that particular person. The complexities I talk about now require that families go to a variety of administrative hearings before they can access regional center. So if you are a recipient of Medi-Cal and you want speech therapy, which the regional center should be able to provide to you, you are instead told you need to pursue an administrative hearing against the state Medicaid agency before regional center will then authorize the service. That is made even less logical by the fact they're all Medicaid-funded service. It actually doesn't matter whether regional center provides the service or whether it is provided through the state Medicaid agency, because it will all, at least at this moment in time, be reimbursed by the federal government at 50 cents on the dollar. So let's eliminate that complexity. Let's restore regional centers to the effort of coordinating services, but not sending families off to sort of do battle with a number of other agencies who probably have less of an incentive to provide the service to a regional center consumer because they know the regional center in the end is the backstop for that service. We also know of barriers when families have private insurance where families cannot access the private insurer because the insurer does not have an adequate number of providers. And instead of having the family have to go through an appeal process with that, what if instead we said regional centers, you know who the big providers are that work with your family, determined if there's an adequate network. If there isn't, then you're authorized to provide that service directly as opposed to families having to go against the private insurance carrier to get the service. As we briefly talked about before, expand the capacity of regional centers and service providers to deliver culturally responsive services. Target operation fund increases to reduce service coordinator caseloads. I'm thrilled to hear about the model that East LA is using and other models such as navigators or promotorios that have been mentioned in the past. Ensure that we're hiring bilingual service coordinators and paying bilingual differentials as is appropriate. Expand regional center vendors' capacity to communicate with their clients. One of the largest barriers to receiving services is that the provider does not speak the language that the family speaks. That may require some additional rate adjustments when providers are providing bilingual services so that people can access them. Finally, expand language access. We are currently representing a regional center mother who has an intellectual disability. She's a monolingual Chinese speaker. She also has a child who is a client of the regional center. This family was receiving supported living services until the provider, the vendor, determined that they could no longer serve her. They communicated that fact to the mother in English, did not provide a written notice. She did not understand that if she lost the supported living service, that she would also lose her rent subsidy. So the service ended. She never got notice from the provider, nor did she get notice from the regional center, and she has been out of services for 6 months now. We're now representing her in an effort to get the service restored. But much of that could have been avoided had we done the right thing at the front end, which is, one, communicate in the language that the person can understand, and through a person-centered planning process, work with that family to identify the other services and supports that are culturally appropriate, that provide services in a language that she could understand, so that she and her daughter, both of whom are regional center clients, would not be left without those services for 6 months. We should provide clarity about which translation costs are operational versus for the individual client. That came up with the example that was given earlier. Public meetings are operation costs, and the translation associated with that should be paid out of a regional center's operation budget, not out of a purchase of service budget for that individual family. Consider more effective ways to translate documents, including perhaps a single contract that the state administers so all the regional centers can use that and have their services, their documents translated, particularly for less common languages, in a more efficient way. There also seems to be a concern about a median rate for translations that we should consider revising. Ensure that the annual statement that tells consumers and families the services they're authorized to receive be provided in the family and consumer's native language. And finally, ensure that both the regional center and the service provider notify the consumer, where appropriate, their family in writing and in their native language before a service is terminated. So a long list of things that we think could be done. Many of these can be done legislatively. We hope that you'll be receptive to looking at some of the legislative solutions. Others, I think, involve collaboration between the department and regional centers and other stakeholders in the community, and we look forward to working with those agencies to implement some of these recommendations as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Barbara Wheeler. I'm the Associate Director of the University Center for Excellence in DD at USC. I've been in that role for ever, long time. And I've had the privilege of working with a lot of the LA regional centers. I tend to feel that the issue is not with DDS, but with regional center directors. I think the directors set the tone for their organizations. And when the tone really embraces addressing POS disparities, it happens. And I think Lori is a very good example of that. I've always enjoyed working with her. I've also worked with a lot of minority parent groups, so I hear it from that end. So I'm just going to give you some quick examples. I see I have four and a half minutes left. There's a difficulty keeping the momentum going. So we all know that racial disparities is present in almost every service system. I'm very discouraged that I heard from families when we were helping them prepare for public testimony that one family said that they heard from their regional center director that he did not like the term disparity. He liked the word variance and wanted to start using that word instead. Variance is defined as a fact or quality of being different. I know you guys know that. But disparities, on the other hand, refers to the creation of better off and worse off groups, because decisions associated with differences in resource allocation, so that's POS authorization and expenditures, which are avoidable and perceived as unjust. So they are not the same thing. And we should use the term openly in our collective efforts, or we are going to go back to the first 21 years before DRC passed the trailer bill language that we need to post disparities. I find that very discouraging when that's the leader of a regional center saying that in a public hearing. I want to also talk a little bit about the ABX 21 proposals because some interesting things, I sort of did an analysis of those and wanted to share my thoughts about that and whether I think that's going to make a significant difference on POS disparities in general. So three root causes of racial disparities: lack of understanding or experience with diverse cultures. Eight of the regional centers and their equity proposals included training for staff on cultural competence. Four more identified training for staff in person-centered thinking / cultural competence, and one included training on person-centered thinking. I wasn't clear if there was a belief that person-centered thinking is the same as cultural competence. I've had people who believe in family support, and they say, well, I'm family-centered, so I'm also culturally competent. And they're really, they're different. They are intertwined. So I worry about the one regional center that says we just need training in person-centered thinking. I think that we have to really be comfortable with the fact that person-centered thinking, while it is the way the system is going and a key value, it does clash culturally with some groups who really value collective decision-making, and the system is saying your son or daughter has a right to make this decision without you. And so that doesn't work as well. The other thing that I found was the regional centers, many of them included cultural competence training in their proposals. There were many of them. But I, as a person who does training all the time, I fundamentally do not believe giving people information changes their behavior. It starts with cultural competence training, but if regional center administration doesn't then take their staff and say, how are we going to apply that with every step of the regional center process, starting with intakes, assessments, service coordination, the IPP process, then people hear it, and it's the service coordinators, et cetera, who deal with families, it doesn't get implemented. And then there needs to be very focused management oversight that those practices are adopted. And I think people feel that training is enough, and it just isn't. So I'd rather people didn't do it. Otherwise, it's just used as an excuse. So the next piece is minority clients, receive services from providers who lack an understanding of culturally responsive approaches. Many of the proposals included what I call cultural brokers, but different ones. So nine proposed the promotora. Three regional centers use Fiesta Educativa. I can certainly understand that. Regional centers are hiring Vietnamese, Korean, Mandarin outreach workers, bilingual service coordinators, navigation specialists, navigators, and reducing the caseload for those service coordinators who work with underserved populations, which I think really makes sense. All of which are good ideas, but until we evaluate, I didn't read the whole proposal. I only read what they did. If there isn't evaluation of all those methods, we don't know which one should be adopted by all the regional centers. I also firmly believe that the notion of local autonomy should not be applied when we're dealing about issues of chronic inequity. If we find something works and you serve a similar population, everybody should adopt it within the system. When everybody does that, then you should have a full court press and we should start seeing the numbers going down. But everybody's deciding how they're going to deal with this. It just messes it up, and where we have strength in sort of changes in the regional center, it gets muted by stuff that's not done as well. The last piece I wanted to talk about is bias, discrimination, and prejudice. It's not a happy topic to talk about. And I just want to remind people that most bias is implicit bias. We all do it. We all have lenses we apply to people, every single one of us. Most bias is unconscious, but it doesn't mean it doesn't have a negative impact. So I think we have to address that at the organizational level, and I really highly recommend that regional center management really do that assessment of their not only their whole organization, but their management team, because the management team basically sets the tone for the rest of the organization. And this is my last statement. Give me another couple minutes. While I commend the DD system for investing in the potential solutions which came out through those, and they were great ideas, I fear that the diversity of the proposals and then very different approaches to the same concept, such as the cultural broker, cultural competence training. With all of that sort of mishmash, you will have no test of whether any of those things really work. And that is unfortunate. But it allows people to sort of do it their own way. So if we could get regional centers to get together, everybody who has cultural competence training, and say, we think this is the best way to do it, let's all do it this way, then we can really test whether that will make a difference in terms of addressing disparities.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, welcome back. So if you could just briefly respond to at least some of the points we've heard today. And I am going to ask after the hearing today if the two of you, maybe together, or we could have from the department at least a report back within a reasonable period of time on, you know, given what we've heard today and the continuing challenges, some sort of near term and longer term sort of goals, timetables, and how we're going to get there.
Okay, just wanted to quickly review a few things, and I'll try to keep it as brief as possible. First, wanted to touch on some things that the Association of Regional Center Agencies has done over the last few years to try to spread the word about what's working. We wouldn't call these best practices, but certainly promising practices. So shortly after the last hearing on this topic, the association developed an equity committee that the different regional centers were invited to participate in, with the real goal, kind of a two-pronged goal. First, sharing promising practices, so talking about those things that people were trying in their own communities and what seemed to be working and what were some challenges that people were encountering. We, over time, invited Disability Rights California, as well as the State Council on Developmental Disabilities, to participate in this group. And over time, the emphasis of the group became to focus on really trying to drill down in the root causes of this issue. And the group felt very strongly that a study on this issue was necessary in order to spend time with different groups, doing focus groups, doing a deep analysis of the data, and so really focused their efforts on trying to identify a funding source for that. Additionally, annually, the association aggregates the data from the regional center reports that they post on each of their websites, as well as the meeting input that they provide to the department, and shares that among centers so that everyone's aware of the high-level things that everyone else is doing. I also wanted to take a couple of minutes just to talk about next steps from our perspective, because I think it's good that we've spent this afternoon talking about some of the challenges that we're encountering, but I think the natural question is, where do we go from here? And so I wanted to present four basic steps that we would encourage the legislature to consider. First is that comprehensive independent study. We have been working with the department closely on trying to identify a way to make that happen, really not as an excuse to stop progress, but as an ability to take a deep look at this issue and to inform next steps, to inform future steps. So while we're working with the current grants on the $11 million that's currently available to figure out if any of those strategies work, really looking at the deeper issues that may be driving some of the disparity that we're seeing and devising future steps from those discussions and those evaluations. Second, I just wanted to second what Marty Amoto said in terms of providing a resource for funding of the startup costs for services that are directly responsive to this these various populations. Currently, the state has a proposed trailer bill language related to making the community placement plan funds startup funding more flexible to address community needs, and we strongly support that as a mechanism to move the system forward. Third, I think we've heard a lot of folks talking today, including Ms. Martin, Mr. Emoto, Ms. Blakemore, as well as others, about the impact that the suspension of critical family support services had on the system and had disproportionately on minority communities. And so we would encourage the legislature to consider mechanisms to reverse those suspensions and the cap on respite. And finally, the way that our caseload ratios are structured in the regional center system, those individuals who receive the most services and have Medi-Cal are provided with the richest caseload ratios. And those who either don't have paid regional center supports or don't qualify for Medi-Cal for a number of reasons are budgeted for less case management time. And so we would encourage the legislature to consider a consistent caseload ratio for both of those groups. Currently for the Medicaid waiver population, it's a 1-to-62 ratio. And for the other population, it's 1-to-66. And we would just ask for consideration that all populations be treated uniformly and that a 1-to-62 caseload ratio for those groups be applied. Thank you.
In, in terms of reducing the disparities, do you think the regional centers are the best vehicles to drive that change?
I get the impression that regional centers certainly are a piece of the puzzle. It's really that dialogue with their local communities and community leaders that's going to help us develop the solutions. If there were easy solutions, we wouldn't be sitting here today 5 years later. But I think it's going to take building trust and having open and honest dialogues, continuing to have open and honest dialogues about these issues to really get to the root of the issue and how we can best address it.
And what do you say to, I believe it was Ms. Martin's point about the budgeting structure, and you know, she advocated sort of, I think she called it blowing it up and starting from scratch, because it, you have, I guess, some a self-perpetuating system, according to her, that higher funded centers continue to be higher funded, lower funded centers continue to be lower funded. Do you have a response to that?
It's a really complex issue, and there were efforts a few years ago to move some of that funding around. But it really has to do more with what services people are seeking in a particular community. It has to do with developing those relationships and really working with individual communities to figure out how to best meet their needs. From my perspective, it's not an issue of how regional center purchase of service funds are allocated to the centers, that it's something more complex than that.
Okay. So what I would say is, I don't know if it would be sort of a separate response from the centers and from the department, but or a combined response. But just in terms of what our ultimate outcomes are going to be, or what you think they should be, how we're going to get there, and you know, you just enumerated a number of ideas, but mm-hmm. sort of putting that in a formal response to the committee. And I know that some ideas will be, you know, we need funding to do this, and that's fine, but I would really have a strong preference that it not all be that, and I know you wouldn't do that. Sometimes there's a tendency to say, legislature, just give us more money and we'll fix these things, and, you know, we want to make sure that, and we know funding is always a partial driver of some of these challenges, but it's not clearly not the only driver. And perhaps would 60 days be doable to have that response?
We can do that from the department's perspective.
Okay, so maybe separate responses? I don't know how you typically work together.
I would recommend give us a chance to kind of take a look at how to best approach. Because as a department, we have two reports that are coming out. So I'd like to see how I can kind of add to that. Okay. But at the same time, we're always happy to work with our regional center partners and ARCA so we can have some discussions and make sure that we deliver. But we can certainly do it within 60 days.
Sounds doable.
And do you think it should be separate responses or a combined response?
I'm going to recommend that we do a separate response, but at the same time, I don't think it's done in a silo, though, because I think together we have to say, how are we going to do this together? But what we can do is make sure that there's definitive action items as a department, but then also definitive action items as regional centers. So there's, okay. we'll absolutely continue the collaboration and see how, as a system, that we can address the issue.
Okay, and I also, I should have also mentioned, I think I'd like timetables in there for how long you think it'll take to achieve different outcomes.
Sure.
Obviously with the, you know, the 5 years since the last hearing, there's a concern, which I think we all share, that we want to make sure we have timetables attached to these outcomes. Okay. And I'm sorry, and I think, and now it's to close. You get the last word before public comment.
Well, I will never have the last word, but I'll certainly provide. I'd like to be able to use this opportunity to provide just some thoughts that we have as a department. And certainly with the recommendations and the concerns that have been shared, I think some of the areas in which we've already been able to take a look at and seeing how we can address and move forward. But we'll also take the information that we're hearing today as well to help provide us input to be able to move, you know, our plan forward as well. So as a department, we'll continue to provide the oversight and the areas that we need to continue to monitor. Some of these things we've already talked about, we're going to continue that commitment. But also there is an area that was discussed today as far as a concern regarding the use of purchase of service dollars over operations in the instances of translation. And so this is an example in areas in which we can provide guidance and direction to the regional centers to make sure that we can address immediate issues that we're hearing today. And should additional areas of concern come up that we can immediately address, we'll certainly do that. We're going to monitor the performance contracts. We're going to continue to use the national core indicators as a measure to determine satisfaction and make sure that we can have the surveys available in languages for anybody who is responding to those surveys in the language of preference or in instances of monolingual families in their primary language. Ensuring that updates of the Regional Center Oversight Dashboard is up to date for the transparency, and then monitoring Regional Center statutory requirements for board composition. I'd also like to say that by May 31st that we're going to be receiving from the Regional Centers the updates and the plans that they have from their purchase of service public meetings, but included in that is that we're asking for an update on the $11 million in the proposals. While the implementations are early on, what we're using this opportunity for is to have submitted to us then the measurable and the qualitative and quantitative efforts and how the regional centers are going to be able to measure that progress. So that is what we're going to be able to do within informing that report. In addition to these efforts, I'm committed to furthering our obligation through a number of other areas. You had requested a plan. We've actually already been working on a plan to be able to start identifying and bridging the gaps in service access. This plan is going to review what the current actions from the department and the regional centers have been working on. We're looking at making sure that we can strengthen the connections with our diverse Asian communities because we're seeing that there's an underrepresentation within our population in this area. We're wanting to develop more sophisticated measures of disparities that can account for the demographic differences among our consumers. It's going to allow us to better track and to understand the consumer preferences. We're also going to want to create systems where we can measure progress, because making sure that we're able to understand what we need to measure to be able to, A, demonstrate where progress is or if there's lack of progress. And then also using our new research unit to be able to help guide us through new data collection that's going to be able to provide us information that's going to be helpful. I've also identified the need to be able to have a Director's Disparity Advisory Group, which is going to be bringing together some experts within the field, also some family members, to be able to give myself some input as far as what are the areas in which we need to continue to not only measure, but also take a look at the recommendations and see how we can best address some of these critical issues. There was a panelist that had said to keep the momentum going, this is what I see this group being able to do for us at the department, is to be able to hold us accountable and making sure that we're moving these efforts forward. Also, the stakeholder meetings and outreach for the next $11 million. We had gone out to do public meetings last year. We're going to continue that effort. We're going to make sure that we move the stakeholder meetings to be informed as to the best use of the next funds that are coming up and being able to include that in the guidelines. We as a department are working with the partners with the three University Centers for Excellence in Developmental Disabilities, the USEDS, Disability Rights, and the State Council. There's an opportunity to be one of 10 states that can be selected for applying for the participation in a Georgetown University project. This project is intended to help leaders and build a tightly network of community to be able to address these really critical issues. It's a five-year project. I'm very optimistic that we're going to be able to submit an application that's going to be able to be strongly considered to help California through this critical issue. National core indicators, we're going to add areas to be able to continue the measurement similar to the adult survey. We're going to expand that to the children's survey as well. We're going to remain committed to pushing forward self-determination program, making sure that we're getting the training out to the community so the broader community can understand what the opportunities are with self-determination once we have an approved application. We have the trailer bill language for the community placement plan that is part of the governor's budget. The intent of being able to have opportunities for developing the community placement plan will be able to address some of the issues, I think, that were raised today. So, for example, when we're able to do priorities for CPP, for when we're looking at early start kids, as an example, making sure that that opportunity for developing resources, especially in the areas of underserved communities. Our guidelines actually for this year will, if we are approved to move forward with the trailer bill language, will outline those priorities to make sure that we are addressing the underserved communities prior to addressing additional issues outside of certainly our closure of the developmental centers and our challenging services needs. But lastly, I have an accountability and compliant position that is being designed. We're moving an existing position at the department to be able to focus primarily on two areas of priority for the department. The first one is with the issue of disparity and with the inequity of access to services, being able to work with the regional centers. This is outside of our cultural specialist. This is a position that will look to the accountability and making sure that we're looking at best practices and being consistent across the state. So these are the areas in which I'm really going to be focusing on this next year, and we'll be including that in the plan. So just to give assurances and hearing the concerns, we know that this is a critical issue. I'm personally committed to it, I'm personally committed to continuing to have the dialogue with our partners, but also with the stakeholders and working with the regional centers to make sure that we can move the system forward with addressing the issue, and we're not back here in 5 years on having the same discussion. So thank you.
Thank you. And in terms of there was an issue raised earlier about the proposals that DDS has received for the $11 million and that they're not available on the website. Are you... it would be great to post those on the website.
Yeah, I'd have to check. I think we have a summary, but I think specifically was looking for the full proposal, and we can certainly do that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay, that is our final panel. We'll now move to public comment. And we would ask public commenters, if possible, to keep the public comment to about a minute and a half. Is there a bell? Make a bell. Okay, thank you.
Hi. Good afternoon, Mr. Chair. My name is Fernando Gomez, and this is my wife, Elizabeth, and we appreciate this opportunity to address you. And first of all, I want to say thank you. As a parent, we have that sixth sense, that intuition of who really is listening. And sitting here today, we can see that it is not falling on deaf ears. So thank you for your time and concern on that. Behind me, there are about 32 parents. A week ago, when we heard about this hearing, we knew we had to be here. So we jumped through hoops and did everything possible to be here. The conversations that have been taking place today is really representative in this room within these parents and the self-advocates. There is a lot of different, in a minute and a half, I can't share all the different, you know, thoughts and points I want to share with you. But one of the things I wanted to do say is that I have to take accountability as a father. I don't have a son with Down syndrome. We are a family with Down syndrome. So that accountability, I think, has to also transcend to the regional centers that serve us. We hear about disparities being referred to as variance. We hear about disparities referred to as residential livings and so forth. But there is no accountability. Where does somebody say, listen, we've messed up. 5 years ago, you had this conversation. 5 years later, you're still having this conversation. Let's start from the beginning. Please include our voice. Let us be part of that decision-making, that strategy-making points across the table so that we can make that change.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Hi. What I really want to say here is want to say, express my gratitude to you, just like my husband did. But I also want to let you know that we are Hispanic community that a lot of the times English is our second language, so it's difficult for us sometimes to express ourselves. But I think it's important that I share with you that the 30 families that were driving here today came here for a reason, and that was because we felt that this was our opportunity to be heard. I think that there's something that's happening here, and it's even felt in this room. We are saying something, but nobody's really listening to us. We have been attending public hearings for the last 5 years, actually maybe even 10. But we've been attending public hearings. We show up. We go to the director, executive director's offices. My husband is—he actually didn't have the time to tell, but he's been very involved. We've done everything possible that we can, and we still have nobody really is really responding to what we're bringing up, the questions that we have. And I think that the experts. I think if they just kind of listen to what we're saying, we're speaking the barriers, and the barriers exist. And so we would like for, as the families come and show and share their testimony or their comments, I would like you to please give us the hope that we came here with, which was that this time somebody would be listening. All we're asking is let us be part of the solution. When we become part of, when we try to be part of the solution, we're actually perceived as troublemakers or parents who are never happy or even judged in many different ways, and that's not the case.
Thank you. Next speaker.
We are Dottie and Larry Lopez from Eastern Los Angeles Regional Center. We are a family with autism. We have two daughters who are nonverbal autistic, and we're representing them. They chose to live outside in their own homes in the community. IPP was written. Services were provided. I made a drawing for the service coordinator. They were authorized for supported living services. They were authorized for personal assistance services. They were authorized for day program or community integration services. They're authorized for items in the IPP, but then it gets real complex. I'm tired of that word. It gets real complex in getting a provider to provide them services. And so the discussion with the service coordinator and with the unit supervisor and with the chief of consumer services up the ladder, it gets too complex. And then we become troublemaker parents. I should have worn my T-shirt. But what's so critical is that they could die. We got to Zoom back after this hearing because we got to provide supported living services for them. It's on their IPP. But they could die one day if we are on the road and we get in a car accident. And who's going to be there at their homes for them? You know, a young man died in Whittier who is left on a public transportation, I mean the school bus. I don't know if you heard about it. And now that whole issue of how do we make sure we don't leave our special needs, nonverbal pupils on a bus. Okay, well, are you waiting to get and see that in the newspaper that our population was left unattended in the homes, although they had an IPP that said these were authorized services? And it all gets back to something real simple, not complex. When is there going to be service coordinators who are social workers and not just technocrats that are really good working that barracuda, you know, confidentiality, sending paperwork. When are they going to start listening and wanting to hear us and hearing that we want to be part of the answer? Whenever I make a recommendation, I get an NPA, notice of proposed action, can't do it. Never really saying why. That's not what I want for my girls. I want them to do what they want to do in the community. And I don't want to be in a contentious relationship with Regional Center, but that's why I'm up here. Because this has gone on for 8 months, and I'm always told in 2 weeks. But I'm not the only family in this boat. And one easy thing the Regional Center could do from top down is to be less intimidating, not only to parents like me, my first language is English, my second language is Spanish, but to all parents. You know, when they say there's other families in the same boat, sir, man, oh, who are those families? Tell me who those families are. I won't talk to you until you tell me who those families are. I mean, I thought I was the only one that was told that until I talked to other people. So intimidation is prevalent in DDS, and I think it's got to change.
Thank you very much.
I'm just here to support my wife, and I just wanted to say that I think it's outrageous that we have to drain our own finances to get a lawyer to get Regional Center to comply with what's written in the Landerman Act. It's outrageous. There's no excuse for that.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hi, my name is Shannon Primer. I'm from San Diego Regional Center, but I do represent clients in Orange County. I'm an educational paralegal, and I hear these stories every single day. I'm also a Talk About Curing Autism Now mentor, so I help other parents get services, and I am a parent. And as our children age out, this is just going to get worse. My child's 15 and a half, and it already scares me that at 22, I don't know what our plan is because there's not enough help, and Regional Center needs to get it together. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hi, my name is Timory Torres. I'm with the Kern Regional Center. I live in Tehachapi, California. I have a son who has autism, and he is 17. For the last 6 years, we have received zero services. Our caseworker does not get back to us. I email, I call, we do not hear from him. We missed the last IPP. He's overdue for his IPP that was supposed to be in December. And when I tried to email, about a month later, I finally got a response that our worker had left and nobody had informed any of the parents. We are still waiting to get in contact with the new worker. And there are services. We live in a rural area, and there aren't a lot of services in our town. Most families, I'm involved in the community with a lot of other families who have individuals with special needs, and everybody seems to have the same story. Nobody is getting any services whatsoever. Social rec was cut, SLS is cut. There's nothing available. Most people just give up. Our family members do not get what they need. There are services out of the area that we're willing to take our children to, but we are not allowed to access those. I don't understand why when other regional centers, I know that these services are vendorized by other regional centers. So why can't we access them? We can't seem to get an answer on that. There is a specific program I would like for my son to be able to access, and I have been requesting it for 2 years. My worker refused to even submit the request, so I have not even been able to get to the point where I can appeal. That's just kind of the story that we all deal with, and we would just like some cooperation and the respect of being responded to so that we can move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Hi, I'm Felicia Molinedo, and my son is 3. I'm new to all of this, and I just want to show you his. Well, can you hear me? This is his. You have to talk on the mic? Oh, okay. Well, this is his entire case right here. And this is a picture of him. That's my son, Shay. And when he turned 3, he was completely dropped of services because I guess that's when school district is supposed to take over. But unfortunately, because of this gap, He was kicked out of preschool, and then I was fired from my job. So my job, I worked at Lakeshore because you can only work part-time when you have a child with autism, unless maybe some of you are able to work full-time. I don't know. But I had a very simple job at Lakeshore because Lakeshore has excellent things that my son could benefit from, but Lakeshore is very expensive. So I worked there to get the discount so I can get him the things he needs. But he used to have an occupational therapist on Mondays, speech therapist on Tuesdays, et cetera, et cetera. They would take him out of the ratio, so his teachers were not inundated with him all the time and his behaviors. Once all that stopped at 3 years old, they couldn't handle him anymore. And in that folder, I have a letter that says that Jay cannot go to that school anymore because they can't handle him anymore. Consequently, I can't find him another school, and now I lost my job. So Regional Center could have really helped me out with that and said, until this is all done, maybe even give a 3 month or 6 month gap, but to just drop my son of all services, I don't even know what to call that, abandonment? I don't know. But now he doesn't have a school, and I don't have a job. Thank you, Regional Center.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hi, my name is Myra, and I'm here with my husband, David Mesquita. Our goal is to help implement systematic change on how regional centers operate, because of the tremendous need to provide fair and equal services and a balanced equity of POS expenditures. I feel that the regional centers need to stop imposing their biased plans that do not adequately meet the needs of the individuals they serve. What is missing is very important. Our voice. 50 years ago, the Lanhamet Act was put together by families and self-advocates like the ones are here today. I don't know how it happened, but today our voice is not part of the equation. We as parents and self-advocates are discouraged, blocked, and intimidated should we dare question a regional center employee. Intimidation and retaliation is not uncommon. We do not want to fight, argue, or be at odds. We just want regional centers to help us. We know what is best for our children and for ourselves. Regional centers are supposed to be here to help us and not find ways to deny us services. Systematic change is needed now. We are ready to become a part of that voice and help the disparities on the road to fair equity for all. Thank you for listening with an open mind and open heart.
Thank you very much. Sir, before we go to the next speaker, I have to go and vote in another committee. They're voting right now. So I'm going to take about a three to four minute recess so I can vote and come back. Since there are no other senators here, if I leave, we have to take that pause. If there were another senator here, we'd be able to continue. So I apologize for that, but we're going to take a 3 to 4 minute recess. You can stay in line where you are. And I apologize for this. I will be back as soon as I can vote and walk back. I'm the fastest vote in the West. Okay, I think that was actually less than 3 to 4 minutes. So, okay, my apologies, everyone. Next speaker.
Well, thank you very much for letting us speak on behalf of our children. I had a nice letter to say, but after hearing everything during this whole meeting, if on the legislature level, you guys want to implement accountability, then it should start from the top down, not at a lower level on the regional. If you try to hold the accountability on the director and it doesn't come from you and everybody below you, then it's obviously been seen for many, many years that it does not work. Hold everybody accountable from the top down, and everybody will eventually have to change, or they can find another job. It's just very simple. Everybody in the world or in the United States that work are accountable for their job and their actions, and yet we don't see anything at the regional level, and that's unacceptable. Because ultimately, our kids, which is the future, regardless of their needs, they have rights, and they've not been heard. Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Christy from Educate Advocate, and we had a day-to-day for lobbying for California families. We presented bills that we support and we oppose. I'm here just to address one of the bills that I think would affect regional center consumers, children with special needs, and that's SB 18, and it was revised. It's in the Ledge Council right now. But there's a couple of different clauses that I'm highly concerned about, including 5B, and I'm not going to read it all, but I'm just going to summarize to say that essentially it's a one size.
And can I just say, I would because the agenda today does not include that bill. If you could talk more generally about the issue as opposed to about a specific bill.
Okay, I just have three clauses I wanted to mention that are okay. Just
yeah,
applicable
just do it
to regional center consumers.
In a more general right. Way, I just want to make sure we're being kosher here.
Okay, so it has to do with one size fits all.
Yeah.
That's one issue. The other issue is children who happen to have behaviors or certain diagnoses allowing it that you have to do a certain standard of care, such as medication. We're concerned about forced medication, forced pharmaceutical medication with these particular children. And then also the school district, there's an area in there about the school district assessing and whatever they say may go, and kind of giving the power over to the school district and perhaps regional center over the parents of children who have special needs. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Next speaker, welcome.
Hello, my name is Daniel Tunis. I came here to speak for all children who cannot do it because I feel tired of being looked at as wasting money instead of seeing us like an investment. This is the opportunity to support us or turn your back on us again and regret it later. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Good afternoon. My name is Xiomara Lopez, and I have a 10-year-old son who is severely autistic and also a consumer of South Central Los Angeles Regional Center. As a mother, I always trusted the professionals at the Regional Center and trusted what they said to me. For years, I've asked for services that could have helped my son, but the response from my service coordinator at Regional Center was always the same: no funds. My son didn't get the opportunity to receive therapies that could have changed his life. Unfortunately, I am not the only parent that has gotten the same answer for when they ask for services. As a Latina mother who was not aware of my son's rights, I feel bad that I didn't get the opportunity to see how these therapies could have helped my son. Time has passed, and nothing or no one can return the time lost. I come here today to demand that DDS takes responsibility for the people who work in the regional centers and demand high standards of service, and to give them appropriate training to do what their work requires, which is to serve the community with disabilities. I think it is time for the regional centers to respect and stick to the Lanerman Act. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hello, my name is Carolyn Medina. I have a son who's 16, and we live in Hesperia, California, and we are with the regional center, Inland Regional Center, sorry. And I'm concerned because my five-year-old, I had applied for services before the tragedy had occurred at Inland Regional Center, and Regional Center did not do assessments and just denied him right off the bat, saying that he just didn't have enough paperwork. Now, my young one, he was 4 at the time, I believe, and he was denied this service. He could have had an early intervention through Regional, but he was just brushed off on paperwork technicalities, and now he's about to be 6 years old. He's gone through all kinds of crisis stuff. He's got developmental disorder delays and profound communication barriers. And he just could have had all these services in Regional Center, Inland Regional Center. I can't blame the other regional centers because I can't say that it was them specific. But our local agency, Inland Regional Center, refused to provide a service that could have been attainable. And he has missed out on those services now. And it would take appeals, due process. Wait a minute, I passed my 30 days. So I guess I'd have to reapply and wait longer, right? At some point, he's going to be a client. There's no way around it because he fits the profile, just like his sibling. But so in collaboration with other parents who also have special needs children with developmental disabilities, I'm discovering that this is across the board. In the high desert area, the Inland Empire, Riverside, San Bernardino, that whole area, children are being denied that are disabled from Inland Regional Services. The center has been shut down. I understand that. However, at the same time, declining and refusing a service for an area that is so large on the California state map with such a heightened level of disabilities in areas of need and poverty, Inland Regional Center needs to step up and do some service for these children instead of just leaving them hanging. I didn't go over my minutes, did I? Okay. I'm so sorry. Sure. No, I'm not. basically, I'm tattletaling. You know, it's not fair to leave little ones without services when they qualify, when they have issues, throwing a blind eye and ignoring them. I've had parents that have been retaliated against for trying to fight, and that's also not appropriate. And I want you guys to know that you guys are in receipt of funding, and you got the Lanterman Act, and so provide accordingly, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hi, I'm Dana McCuller. I'm service coordinator at Alta California Regional Center. We as service coordinators are the link between clients and families and services. We help clients and families even if the services and the clients and families need don't cost the regional center any money. For example, with myself, I do a lot of researching about what's happening in the local community, and especially like at community centers. I do a lot of that. Especially for the purposes of socialization and generalization and inclusion with the clients that I do have on my caseload. And we also access parent support groups that are available within the community but not widely advertised. And I assist in navigating with the parents on generic resources that are available because we are not always able to provide those resources. We also partner with community leaders to help individuals with minority communities learn about regional center services For example, in me gaining the rapport and trust of some of the parents of my clients who happen to be influential within the African American community, some of these parents in turn have invited ACRC or Alta California to come to the local African American mental health fair in order to make known the services that we do have available. There's a lot that I could say about what I am able to provide as an individual, but I actually just wanted to say thank you to the families, because had I not been here, I wouldn't have gotten that perspective of what's happening with other service coordinators. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Maricela Donate.
Good afternoon. My name is Maricela Donate.
Mi hijo es cliente de SCLAR.
My son is a client of SCLAR.
Mi punto es para exponer, quiero hablar del plan de desvariedad.
I would like to speak to you about the POS disparity plan.
By the way, we'll double your time because of the translation, so don't stress out.
Yeah.
Que hizo en mi centro regional de SCLAR. Es un plan que es luce muy bien.
What I would like to speak to you is regarding the POS disparity plan that SCLAR provided. It's a plan that looks very good.
Pero desafortunadamente, SCLAR está vendiendo a los consumidores y no es para todos.
But unfortunately, this is a plan that is more like a sales to some, but it's not for all of them.
Ni tampoco los padres fuimos incluidos en ese plan.
And parents were not included in that plan.
Este es mi hijo Eric Donate.
This is my son, Eric Donate.
I have a letter for him. I don't know. Submitting a letter. Thank you, that's all.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Hello, my name is Stephanie Lopez. I am 16 years old, and I just want to say like a little background. I was a consumer for SCLAR, but I got this line, and I have a younger brother. He got accepted, which that's good, but for me, it's really difficult because in elementary, I had a hard time studying. No one like had my help and nothing like that. I didn't want that for my brother neither. For me, it was difficult because there was nobody to help me around. Not even when I had... I'm sorry. I just want to say that there's students that they need help too, like me. It took me a lot of years to talk, like to stand up and talk like I'm talking today. I would say it took me like around 8 years to stand up and start speaking for myself. And I want to say also that my mom, she's a really hardworking mother, that she works so hard to get services for my brother. And the saddest thing is that I realized like a mother of mine, it's very difficult for her to access services for the regional center system because my mother, she doesn't speak English very well. And apparently the staff from SCLAR, they seem like they don't want to put in effort or don't care what a parent has to say, especially that we're a Latino Hispanic family. They don't really care what they say. Like, for example, when SCLAR had a meeting with us, the mothers were gathered around and they seemed really disrespectful. The director and their management staff were like, what's it called? When the mothers had to say something necessary about their child, they would laugh. They would do hand signs like saying, oh, we don't like them, or shut her up and things like that. And they would just make like unpleasant faces, which it's sad because, I mean, we're trying to have we want our children, our brothers and sisters to have a better life for us. For me, I can't have a future until my brother has a future than me. And
they don't care to deny any services from the consumers, and for us it's a huge impact. And for the families, because they're risking the progress and the advancements for our future, as well as the welfare for the whole nation. And children like that shouldn't be suffering on their own. They should need help. They need services a lot. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Well, my name is Maria Lopez. I am not speaking English. I will try my best. I am here today because the Latino families have already asked. We began been for services and a system change in the fairly way. And nobody does anything to solve this problem. And it is a great disparity that is severely negatively affecting our families, consumers, and the communities. And we are here today to demand all of you, inclusion, respect, and equality for all of the consumers and their families. And we are demanding that everyone present here take own responsibilities and to start working hard to make a change in our system that is completely broken of many years ago because families aren't willing to continue with this because that's not is the purpose of the spirit of the Lanterman Act. Thank you so much.
Gracias. Next speaker.
Antes que nada, mi nombre es Mayra García. No podría terminar hablar de las 16 discapacidades de mi hijo.
My name is Mayra García, and I could not start to tell you about the 16 disabilities that my son actually is diagnosed with.
Tristemente, los coordinadores y los supervisores del centro regional no están preparados.
Unfortunately, the staff from regional centers are not prepared.
Nos desinforman en lugar de informarnos.
They give us the wrong information rather than giving us information.
Nos niegan servicios.
They deny services.
Y los pocos servicios que nos dan.
And the few services that we receive.
Son 50 horas.
Are about 50 hours.
Al mes.
A month.
Que se las gastan en 4 días cuando mi hijo ni siquiera estuvo presente.
And vendors actually report that total of hours in 3 or 4 days, and my son wasn't even present. Okay. She wants me to read her letter. Okay, so I'm the mother of my 16-year-old son, year-old disabled son, Jared Garcia. I came here today to speak on his behalf and to represent him, seeing that he cannot fight for his own rights. What is the point of my son having a well-equipped wheelchair, especially adapted to him, if there is no way to transport it and use it anywhere? He needs it the most out in the community. His wheelchair does not fit in my vehicle, and I do not have sufficient funds to purchase a more spacious vehicle. Access refuses to offer services to my son due to his behavior issues and his discomfort being around other people. So how can my son enjoy a day out in the community without his wheelchair? Yes, my son can walk, but only for a short distances. He still requires the assistance of his wheelchair.
This is the behavior. He needs to stay himself all the time. I'm sorry, it's not working. But he hit all the people and all the things.
Okay. Gracias. Next speaker, please.
Hello. I'm not speaking English, but I'm going to try my best. My name is Ruby Saldana. I am a mother.
¿Quiere interpretación?
No, I'm going to try my best. That's okay. I'm a mother of children with autism. As a Latino mother, I have been ignored, humiliated, and discriminated by Escalar staff mainly the people who are supposed to have to help me. I discovered and supported by the executive staff. Over the time and too much effort, I was available to acquire more knowledge and become a leader. I noticed that all discrimination and humiliation that I have experienced, many regional centers families have also experienced. And for this, I have three simple steps for all these problems, the disparity. I work for some place that is a store, and we do this, and it's simple. DDS must take a neutral part that can not be controlled by regional centers, and the executive director of this neutral part should be the same clients or their parents. Rotate from time to time the executive staff of the regional centers and demand high standards of quality and excellent customer service. All this with the purpose of improving quality levels and not staying comfortable and stagnation at the same level and position for the 4 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
I need translate.
Is there someone who can interpret?
Mi hijo está en el Centro Regional Harbor.
My son belongs to Harbor Regional Center.
Él es diagnosticado con autismo.
Diagnosed with autism.
Se le han negado servicios verbalmente.
He's been denied services verbally.
No me han querido dar la carta de negación.
They have never given me a letter of denial.
No me ayudan con los servicios apropiados.
They do not help me with the appropriate services.
Que necesita a mi hijo como cliente de Centro Regional Harbor.
Services that he deserves of being a client of Regional Harbor Regional Center.
Para mejorar su habilidad en la vida diaria.
In order to become better in his daily activities.
Los coordinadores niegan servicio porque no.
Coordinators deny services because.
No califica el cliente.
Because a client may not qualify.
Por edad.
Because of age.
O tipo de deshabilidad.
Type of disability.
En la actualidad recibe el niño servicio de socialización.
In actuality, my son receives social skills therapy.
El cual tardó 10 meses en aprobarse.
The one took 10 months to be approved.
El servicio de respiro que tengo ahora.
The respite that I receive now.
Es 24 horas.
24 hours.
Cuando recibí la facturación anual de servicios del Centro Regional Harbor.
When I received the annual report from Harbor.
Ellos están poniendo 5 meses.
They added 5 months.
De 48 horas.
48 hours.
Que yo recibo solo 24.
But she only receives 24 hours.
Pido a DDS y a las personas encargadas.
I'm asking DDS and the people in
intervengan
charge.
Haciendo investigaciones.
To please intervene and do some investigations.
Tomen cartas en este asunto, por favor.
Take matters into your hands, please.
Ya que Centro Regional ha negado servicios a varias familias hispanas.
Since Regional Center has denied many services to Spanish families, Hispanic families.
Los coordinadores no dan bien las informaciones sobre los servicios.
The coordinators do not give correct information about the services.
Que están a disponibilidad del cliente.
They are supposed to be available to the client.
Necesitamos su apoyo.
We need your support.
Y de antemano les agradezco su atención y su colaboración.
I thank you for your
support. Muchas gracias por escucharnos.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Buenas tardes, apreciables servidores públicos. Mi nombre es Cecilia Ortiz, mamá de Carlos Hernández.
Good afternoon. My name is Cecilia Ortiz. I'm the mother of Carlos.
Él es cliente actualmente del Centro Regional Harbor.
He's a client of Harbor Regional Center.
Ser padre no es tarea fácil, pero ser padre de un individuo con necesidades especiales.
To be a parent is not an easy task, but it's even a lot more difficult with a child with special needs.
Es una tarea muy laboriosa y constante abogacía.
It's a very difficult task to do.
El diagnóstico no es lo más difícil.
The diagnosis is not what is the most difficult.
Lo más difícil es enfrentar día con día los obstáculos.
What's hard is to deal with day to day with all the obstacles.
Excusas.
The excuses.
Pólizas internas que desarrollan los centros regionales como lo es Harbor.
And the internal policies that are developed, like such as Harbor.
La falta de responsabilidad que los centros regionales tienen para proveerles los servicios.
The lack of responsibility that regional centers have to provide the services.
A sus clientes es lo que conlleva a que sus familiares estemos constantemente en demandas.
This is what leads family members to be constantly demanding or demanding.
Cada vez que el cliente necesita o solicita algún servicio.
Every time the client needs or requests a service.
Que es esencial para poder funcionar y el cual ayudará al individuo.
A service that may be essential and that may help the individual.
A que se pueda integrar en la comunidad.
So that he can, integrate into the community.
Y por ende tener una vida digna e independiente.
And to have a dignified life and independent.
Necesitamos cambios en el sistema.
We need changes in the system.
Y más responsabilidades por parte de los centros regionales.
And a lot more responsibility from the part of the regional centers.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Hola, buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Guadalupe Nolasco y esta tarde traigo el testimonio de María Artuno.
My name is Guadalupe
Nolasco.
Nolasco, and she's bringing somebody else's testimony.
What's her name? María Artuno.
She's bringing María Artuno's testimony.
La señora Patricia del Mónico limita los servicios a nuestra gente y nos dificulta encontrar ayuda apropiada para nuestros seres queridos.
Mrs. Patricia del Mónico.
Okay.
Mrs. Patricia del Mónico limits the services to our people and makes services very difficult.
No hay oportunidades para nuestros hijos y los pocos lugares que existen son inapropiados para ellos.
There's no vendors for the services and the ones that exist are not appropriate for what's required.
Mientras las oficinas de HRC está ubicado en una excelente zona, lo cual es un gasto excesivo y gastos innecesarios a mi parecer.
Even though the offices of the Harbor Regional Center are located in a very beautiful area, in my opinion, inappropriate to provide the services.
Mientras nuestros seres queridos tienen muchas necesidades y carecen de oportunidades.
Since our loved ones are missing the services and lack the opportunities.
Gracias por escucharnos.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hi, my name is Jordan Graham. My husband and I have a 7-year-old son who has severe nonverbal autism, sensory processing disorder, pica, and a rare chromosome deletion. We've only had him for about a year, but we went through regional center immediately. And they promised us everything. They said everything would be available, respite, IHSS, our IPP is outdated by years. And we have nothing. So after a year of emails and follow-ups, my service coordinator doesn't even usually call me back. So I just want to thank you guys for hearing everybody's concerns, and I wish you guys a lot of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Abner Antunes. I'm here to basically demanding high level of service from the people that is responsible to do their jobs. Got to remind you guys, this is a job. Whoever is responsible in running these entities, whoever is in charge of these employees, have a job that they sign up for. They get paid every week or biweekly or monthly, but they get paid some fat checks. Why is that we're not doing the job? I have a job my job is basically to make sure that the groceries yell at you, buy me. You know, that's basically what it is. You know, I work for a supermarket chain, and my job is to provide excellent customer service, high level of quality product, and safe store every day. We deal with government entities like health department, ways and measures, and we're required of high levels of service. We're not allowed to leave a customer, to let a customer get out of the store unhappy. Our job is to make sure that customer wants to come back. I do everything I can, and I have in my power and my knowledge, and I utilize every single tool that is provided to me to get the job done. I don't understand why is that people that my son's future is on their hands, and not only my son, but hundreds of families, hundreds of kids, adults already, some of them teens already. I don't understand if they don't get the sense of urgency that this is urgent. And I don't really see them responding to it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hola, muy buenas tardes. Gracias por su atención a todos del equipo que está aquí.
Good afternoon, and thank you to all of you for.
Y por su tiempo.
And for your time.
Están muy agradecidos todos.
We are all very grateful.
Mi nombre es María Leonor Dimas.
My name is María Leonor Dimas.
Mis hijos se llaman Aileen Dimas, Jonathan Dimas. Son estos mis hijos.
These are my children.
Mi niña tiene parálisis cerebral.
My daughter has a
parálisis cerebral. Parálisis cerebral.
Cerebral palsy.
Severa en visión. Severa en visión. Y mi niño es autista.
And he's also autistic, so three different diagnoses.
Son consumidores de Sclar hace 8 años.
Clients, 8 years ago, clients of Sclar.
Para poder que me dieran los servicios a mis niños, tuve que ir a mediación.
I had to go to mediation to get services for my children.
Para recibirlo lo que ellos necesitan.
To receive just what they need.
Y es, para nosotros padres eso es muy difícil por el idioma.
For us it's very difficult because of the language barrier.
Gracias a Dios tengo los servicios de SCLAR.
Thank God I do have the services of SCLAR.
Pero he tenido problemas porque a veces el departamento el departamento clínico.
But I've had problems because of the clinical department.
Tarda mucho para utilizar.
They do have. They take a long time to authorize.
Para que continúen los servicios.
To continue.
Al tal grado que han tardado y los servicios han parado.
To the point that it's taken so long that the services have stopped.
Esto no es justo para nuestros hijos.
This is not fair for our children.
Y he conocido padres.
And I have met other parents.
Que tienen el mismo problema.
They have the same problem.
Nosotros como padres nos sentimos muy mal.
As a family, we feel
nos sentimos que no nos interesan nuestros hijos.
We feel that they don't care for our children.
Por eso estoy aquí.
This is why I'm here.
Por favor, a pedirles que hagan algo, que haya una solución en este problema.
There be a solution to this problem.
Tan importante para los derechos de nuestros hijos.
It's very important for the rights of our children.
Y por la bienestar de nosotros y la tranquilidad de uno.
And to the well-being of ourselves and for our own peace and tranquility.
Otra vez, gracias por su atención.
Thank you for your attention.
Gracias a todos.
Gracias.
Gracias.
Good afternoon. I want to say first, thank you for your translation, because if you were not here, I would have missed it. I have a special position. I happen to be the chair of the state plan for State Council for Developmental Disabilities. And I also have a son that is an artist that happens to be autistic. And my most recent story, I've been taught by Women's Lead to tell your story, because if you tell your story, people can understand, and maybe they might be able to get in your shoes. I wear the little shoes, so you're not too deep into them. But before my husband retired recently, I was receiving ABA services, which are autistic behavior analysis services, through his private insurance at the age of 33. When my husband retired in July, I lost that private insurance. But my son has Medicare and Medi-Cal, and payer of last resort, regional center, refused an NOA, notice of action, did informal hearing. Out of 60 hours I used to have, they offered me 20 hours. At first I said no because I couldn't understand. I know the law. I'm a well-educated parent. But I still got a denial. So finally I took what they offered. In the end, the reality is you fight the fight, but you take what you can get when you get it, but you continue fighting. You don't let them just think that since you said, since you said yes to that, that's going to be enough. My concern is that, A, again, autism doesn't end at 21, and after the age of 21, there are no service providers for ABA services. Also, I've been approved for supported living, as others have said. There are no providers. I live in Sacramento. Thank you.
Sandra Smith. Hi, I'm Judy Mark. I'm a parent from Los Angeles, as well as work with the Autism Society of Los Angeles, and I sit on the board of Disability Rights California. Today, you've heard from family members and individuals with disabilities from about 11 regional centers that have been identified. It could be more. And what I'm seeing is that there's a serious cultural problem here within both the regional center and in the developmental services in general, that even though we as family members created the system of developmental services, created the regional centers 50 years ago, it has completely flipped. And now it is only responsive to professionals and not enough responsive to parents. They are often an afterthought or window dressing in many of the decisions that need to be made that affect us directly. We are considered problems, we're considered difficult, we're not partners, and we're not getting the kind of respect that we deserve. As you see, a movement has begun. We are coming to change the system like we created it 50 years ago, and we look forward to partnering with you on creating these changes.
Good afternoon. My name is Janelle Lewis, and I serve on the State Council on Developmental Disabilities, where I chair the Legislative and Public Policy Committee. Today, I'm speaking as a parent of a 20-year-old who has autism. I would just like to share that I have over 20 years of experience with education and advocacy and serving on the Senate on task force task forces and work groups for the Senate Select Committee on Autism and the Legislative Blue Ribbon Commission on Autism, and doing everything I can to help people get the services that they need. And that I personally, even though I have all of this knowledge and ability, have had nightmare after nightmare in accessing services for my son. And what I would like to share is that when we talk about disparity, there's a part of the system that I experienced major barriers, and I can only imagine what it must be like for someone who may not speak English as a first language or have other cultural things that enter in. And that is in the due process part of accessing services. If you receive a notice of action, which is a denial for services, which some regional centers issue as sort of a knee-jerk kind of a reaction, you have the opportunity to appeal that through due process. It's a very complex, deck stacked against you kind of a system. And it involves needing legal assistance, which if you can't afford that, or, you know, some people can access low or no cost assistance, but those are very few people. There's just not enough help in that area. It's very complex and intimidating to go through the Office of Administrative Hearings and prepare evidence and witnesses and all that to go against a regional center who has a legal department. So that is another area that needs to be looked at very closely in terms of equity. Also, if you withdraw from an OAH hearing for regional center, it is always recorded as being satisfactorily resolved. So the data is very skewed in that respect. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Hi. My name is Sandra Lewis. This is my son, Marcus Lewis. He was born 28 years ago, very medically challenged, a rare syndrome. I was told it was 40-something cases known worldwide at the time he was born. And it's called Joubert syndrome. There was a portion of his brain completely missing. The central place for that, that part of your brain was your central place for your motor development. So as he grew, he was in a wheelchair, total care, from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. And he also had Dandy Walker syndrome and was never shunted. And so Marcus was very medically challenged. We left the hospital with 7 specialists, an apnea monitor, and I was CPR trained. In 2000, Marcus was diagnosed with a fatal liver disease. And we got involved with UCSF Liver Transplant Division. At that time, Marcus had what I call a major bleed. He was 15 years old, dropped down to 45 pounds. And regional center at that time, actually before that, when I want to go back to when he was born before I left the hospital. Quite a few of the staff came to me and said, he could be institutionalized, Mom. And they said it more than once, even after I told them, no, thank you, I'm taking him home. And so because of the limited respite services we were getting in the beginning, I began to advocate for those when my 15-year-old son had a mental breakdown. He was my right hand and my support in helping to care for his son. So at that time, Regional Center upped the respite hours to 463 hours on the contingency that I get him enrolled in the EPSDT program. And then once we got enrolled in that, they still kept 250 hours of respite. This is a very young man, medically challenged, and he was still wearing an apnea monitor at 25 years old. And so when he had the fatal liver disease, about 2013, I was told by one of the specialists that the ammonia was building up in his brain and he only has a small time to live. So I went to Regional Center and said, we need more respite hours. We only have 90. After some budget cut in 2009, they dropped us down from 250 to 90 hours a quarter. So I was like, I felt like I was a juggler trying to juggle services, and I'm a working woman too. So when he was told, I was told he was terminal, and actually they didn't expect him to live that long, but because of the ammonia buildup in his brain now from the failing liver, what Alta presented to me in terms of in place of respite was, why don't you go and apply for hospice? I told them hospice wasn't in my choice because if there was still a pill or still a reviving, I wanted it for my son. But that's where the stance they seemed to have taken. So I went ahead and applied for hospice. My son did not qualify for hospice because he was 1 point low. He was 1 point higher than what he needed to be on a particular blood draw. He was supposed to be a 2 and he was a 3, which a 2 is pretty critical. You're at death's door anyway. They still wouldn't provide the respite. And I had to go all the way to full-blown court. And in the process of that, I was associated with someone that was helping me, a Michael Rosenberg. And Regional Center kept wanting me to create a calendar because they kept saying something about ISH hours and they needed to figure it all out. And I created this calendar of 24 hours of his life, and they would not believe that I was the one doing that. I was the one providing those services. And I had to take off of work the last 7 months of his life, not knowing I would be his hospice nurse. I was going to court battling with Alta saying, please, I need some time with my son. You talk about disparity. I feel that Alta failed not only my son, but they failed me. The morning he passed, and I came home from the hospital about 2:30, talked to family members, and got in the bed at 7:30. The respite company called me at 8 and said, I got a referral from Alta Regional Center per some court hearing. We need to get together and talk about how much respite he needs. Now, mind you, I told them how much he needed. I said, it's a little too late. He passed away this morning. There's no need for that. My son is very medically challenged and physically challenged, and I was told there's a small percentage in Regional Center. He's no stranger. When he had that major bleed, when he was 15 years old, he was placed into a unit I was told was called a specialized unit for children that need a lot of services. How can you need a lot of services and now you're down to a critical point of life and you don't need them anymore? That's not so. I heard it mentioned that NOAs were flying all over the place. That's what happened to me. I feel that Regional Center failed me and they failed my son because the time that I was being his hospice nurse, and I remember one night counting the alarms of the apnea monitor where he was having his heart rate would go low and he would quit breathing at 500 alarms in less than an hour. I put the pen down and said, enough is enough. What else do they need? They failed. That's disparity. To where it ended to death. And I felt like I was not granted quality time with my son in the end that I could have had because I was so busy trying to be his nurse instead of his mother. Thank you.
Thank you. Our condolences.
Good afternoon. My name is Daisy Funes. I can you give me a favor, Miss Elizabeth, for yes. Tyler and my little. Antes de empezar, quiero agregar algo de lo que dijo la persona que estaba acá.
Before I start, I would like to add something to the person that was, the mother that was just here.
Cuando uno está pidiendo más horas de respiro.
When someone is asking for more respite hours.
Ahora nos dicen, tú tienes in-home support, págalas de in-home support.
Now we hear things like, you have in-home support services, so pay from that those hours.
Yo soy madre de una niña con autismo y Down síndrome.
I am a mother of a child who has Down syndrome and autism.
Yo siempre he dicho, mi hija pertenece a South Central.
My daughter belongs to South Central.
Pero no somos consumidores del centro regional.
But we're not consumers of regional center.
Porque en la actualidad.
Because in actuality.
Mi hija no tiene servicio del centro regional porque nunca. Se los han proveído.
My daughter doesn't have any services from the regional center because they've never provided any.
Voy a empezar a leer mi carta.
I would like to start reading my letter.
Es muy urgente it que is, este problema.
It is urgent for this problem.
De disparidad sea otorgado.
That this disparity problem be given or assigned to.
A una agencia neutral.
To a neutral agency.
Que cuente con un arbitraje libre de conflicto de intereses económicos.
That counts with a free conflict of no conflict of interest. Economic interest.
Que de verdad se preocupen por el bienestar.
An agency that actually does take into account the well-being.
Y aseguren servicios de calidad para todos los consumidores.
And that ensured quality services for all the clients.
Que esta agencia sea conformada.
Let this agency be conformed by.
Por padres que sean defensores de los derechos.
Parents such as parent advocates for their rights.
Y que sean sustentadas por DDS.
And maybe supported by DDS.
Que dicha agencia se comprometa.
And for that agency to have a duty, an agreement.
A educar de manera efectiva a todos los padres.
To train in an effective way to all the parents.
De los consumidores.
And the clients.
Así como a todo el personal de los centros regionales.
As well as the staff from regional centers.
Y hacer uso de los derechos bajo la ley de Lanterma Act.
And to be effective in using the rights written in the Lanham Act.
Que fueron hechos para ser utilizados.
Since they were written to be utilized.
Y aplicado.
And applied.
Por ambas partes.
Through both parties.
Y que el contenido es una maravilla.
And that the content is truly marvelous.
Que todo lo deberíamos conocer.
We should all know it very well.
Solo de esta manera.
Only this way.
Se podría retomar.
We could take over. Or
el control de los centros regionales.
Take back the control from the regional centers.
Que fueron hechos.
Which were made.
Para las familias de los consumidores.
For the families of the clients.
Thank you.
Gracias. Thank you. Okay. Our final public comments are coming up.
Hello, my name is Maynard Dukun. I'm a board member for South Bay Down Syndrome Association. I chose to be the last one because I wanted to hear everybody. And the sad part of this is that the very organization that was formed to help us, and it was formed by parents like me and everybody else here, is the same organization that is failing us. It's, like I say, it's very sad. We will ask you to help us be part of the solution. Like Yuri said, we are here to change things around. And you guys can help us do that. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Josefina Blancas.
Good afternoon, my name is Josefina
Blancas. Mamá de Freddy Sánchez.
Mother of Felix Sánchez.
26 años.
He's 26 years old.
Siempre he pedido al Centro Regional Terapias.
I have always asked Regional Center for Therapies.
Que se me las han negado.
And they've all been denied.
Y las sigo pidiendo
and
y
I'm
las
still,
niegan.
I'm still requesting them and they're still
quiero
denied.
Cambios, por favor.
I would like to see changes,
gracias.
Please.
Gracias. Okay, seeing no additional public comment, we'll close public comment. I want to thank everyone for coming out today, both the members of the public and people who are have family members in the system, and my sincerest condolences to the parents who have lost their children. I know I can't even begin to imagine what that is like, and my thoughts and prayers are with you. And I this was a very eye-opening hearing for me. I'm a new senator. This is, although I've worked on some of these issues in San Francisco in terms of the statewide issues, they're new to me. And so I'm it was very informative to hear directly from people with family members in the system, people in the system themselves, service providers from our state agencies. And so thank you all for that. As I indicated earlier, I have asked the regional centers and the department for a very detailed response within 60 days, including timetables for correcting some of these deficiencies. Obviously it's a lot, and we, nothing happens overnight, but 5 years is too long, and we want it to go faster. So, again, thank you everyone for today, and this concludes the hearing, and so we stand adjourned. Thank you.